Approach, Sky with 6316, 8.8 for 6,000.
Yeah, 6316, North Gale Approach, still maintain 3,000, number one for the right.
3,000, Sky with 6316.
Redwood 811, still maintain 4,000. Airport's open to fog, 1.
We take you higher, been higher, been higher.
You feel it on and over
line. We take you higher, been higher, been higher. You feel it over and over line.
6 Roman Terrafly, runway heading, runway 5. Let's take off.
Check. And we are ready for takeoff. Sit back, relax. It's time to travel with Cosmic Passport. Spaced Out Weekend presents Elizabeth Anglin's Cosmic Passport. A one-hour warm-up of news, stories, thoughts, and ideas to captivate your mind. You can follow us at spacedoutradio.com.
Now 20 years have passed us by, and we look back and count the time. Burning light, the summer sun, when the world was young.
And now, here's our Lady of Flight, Cosmic Passport with Elizabeth Anglin.
Yes, I am.
Oh, Elizabeth is having a computer issue. Well, you're stuck with me then. Elizabeth, are you here?
I am here. Oh. I am here, but we're having Skype issues. Skype is hanging up on me, so I don't know how long I'll be here for.
Oh, you'll be here as long as it takes Skype to keep you here.
Well, and the other thing is, call me if you call me back again. If I drop off, I'll just do this on the phone instead of the big, super, uber Yeti.
Oh, yeah. Really?
Yeah.
But you're doing it on your fancy Yeti now, though, aren't you?
I have, at the moment. But if it's a computer issue with Skype, just call me back and I'll pick up the phone and we'll see if the phone's any
better. You know what we should do? We'll get everybody to call you back.
Everybody, call me back. Call me right now. 1-888.
Operators are standing by for you
to call me.
Elizabeth's cat. Insane with the phone calls. So how are you tonight, Elizabeth?
I'm doing okay. I had a very, very sedate sort of day in my little gallery here. Nothing happened. Had some readings in the morning, and then people came in and didn't buy anything. So it was just sort of like, wow, okay, well, all right then. But it was a weird weather day. It was really hot and then cloudy and rainy. So I think that,
Doesn't help at all.
Nobody likes to shop.
That's here on the left coast. It was basically the same as you. It was insane. Well, it was about in the high 80s and really hot. Yeah. Africa
really
hot. But
muggy.
Really overly muggy because I'm right on the ocean, so it's not too bad.
Yeah.
And it's kind of fine. It's kind of fine. It's kind of fun. Unfortunately, I spent most of it sitting at a computer. And my youngest daughter spent about 8 hours of that in a new dance studio with air conditioning as opposed to her old one.
Oh.
Or else she'd be a lot more miserable than she is right now.
Yeah. She would lose a lot of water weight, too, dancing. I decided that I'm going to move to the general store because they have about umpteen different air conditioners in every window. And I just was like, hey, I could come bring a chair and sit here and say nice things to people for my rent, you know. And I'll just sit in front of the air conditioner.
That's sweet.
Yeah, it'd be sweet. In New Mexico, we have these things called swamp coolers, which are not entirely great on muggy days. They cool off some, but they're not air conditioners.
Yeah, well, aren't your swamps just naturally cool?
We don't have swamps in New Mexico.
Well, then why would you need a swamp cooler?
When it cools by condensation. What happens is the water... And the air over where the water is turning into gas because it's so freaking hot, and the air cools off. But when it's muggy, less water is the air cannot absorb more water. So
all right,
yeah,
I got you.
Thing.
Well, I'm going to be talking to Ron Felber tonight, who wrote the Mojave Incident, and it's a really cool book. And he's giving us a ton of copies. Well, he's giving us a few copies of that in his new book, Dark Angel, for giveaways to our space travelers as soon as we get our private little group up and running. And we have lots of cool stuff to give away. Mojave Incident is actually a true story. He interviewed a couple who were abducted and went through the whole process of going to university and having, you know, the hypnosis and stuff like that, and came up with all sorts of reasons why they were not fibbing. And his new book, which is fiction based on nonfiction, is Dark Angel. He's got a character, Jack Madsen, who is kind of a secret agency kind of guy, but he's going up against super soldiers and genetic programming of human people to make them killers. Which is based on some DARPA experiments, allegedly, that are going on right now. So that's interesting. It's going to be very, very cool. You would think.
Yeah.
You should listen then. Should you not?
I would probably listen. Yeah. Well, I read as much as I could of the Mojave Incident.
Okay, you're breaking up.
Because, you know, it's interesting. Oh, no, I'm not.
No, you
that.
Weren't. You just,
am I breaking up now?
I think you just leaned away from the microphone and did your
I
hair.
Did,
or something.
I did.
Stop
no,
it.
I did my hair. It's really cool now. So I read part of the Mojave Incident as much as I could get through in an hour. I'm a pretty fast reader. But I didn't get through all the university stuff.
Well, that's cool. Yeah, that's cool.
You know, it's interesting to me because it speaks so much to the process of going through fear. And I wanted to talk tonight about, you know, the alien abduction experience is a spiritual emergency, in that it is something that brings up a tremendous amount of fear. Mm-hmm. And often the only way to deal with it is to get on the spiritual path, whatever your spiritual path is, whether you're Mormon or Baha'i, or, you know, I don't know, you worship grubs. It doesn't really matter. If there is something in that spiritually gives you a sense of well-being, safety, usually what will happen with experiences is they will get on that. And so I was noticing that about the woman, Elise Gifford, is that, you know, it seems like, I can't tell from what I did read, but it seems like she got on the spiritual path real quick. Like, okay, let's get on this. So, it should be interesting to see what he has to say about that. So what do you know? Has he talked to you any further about it? Did you get a...
And then she was gone. She did. He did talk to me a little bit more about that. And it is interesting. I'm not going to, you know, if I continue to carry on, I will give the entire thing away. So I'll just, I'll be good. This is me phoning Elizabeth back. Mind you, I'm phoning her on her cell phone. That's going to be interesting. So, maybe I should phone her on a landline. Oh, that's right. I don't have her landline. Oh, that little Dickens. So, Yeah, the Ron Felber interview, he had been on last December, and we talked about his book, The Mojave Incident. Brilliant book. And what he's basically done is come up with I think there is a specific television program that will be featuring the Mojave Incident in October, just in time for Halloween. And we'll see how that goes. You know, Elizabeth, I do not have your landline number. I only have your cell phone. So sorry when you crashed and burned there.
No, you got me.
Oh, this is your landline? Can you hear me? Yeah, I can hear you.
Well, actually, yeah, I'm on the phone. So if Skype is going to work, it's going to work on the phone, or it's not going to work at all. So
you're the psychic. You should know this. I was just saying that Ron did tell me a few things that are kind of cool on some of his books. And since I did talk to him last December, his Mojave Incident has been looked at for a TV episode on a specific paranormal show, which I'll get him to talk about, as well as, I believe, Dark Angel could be picked up for a film, Netflix movie, and one of his other books that's not written, or it's not completed yet and not published, is, that's the one that's for the... I shouldn't just put words into his mouth at this point. We'll have to let him tell you about this. But there's a Netflix movie coming up on one of his books, and another one for I believe is either a feature film or a television series. I can't remember now. You're going to have to wait for another hour, and we'll drag him kicking and screaming in here, and that's how we're going to get that one figured there out, woman.
We'll drag him.
Now that you sound like you're on a phone, so it's very cool. You've got that little distance feeling. So I'm going to let you tell the listener a little bit about what you wanted to talk about tonight, and that is the awakening.
Well, yeah. Also, just some things about fear. One of the things that comes up in the first part of the book that Ron's going to talk about, the Mojave incident, and Elise Gifford, the woman in the book, says that, you know, she felt like the aliens that they saw wanted their soul, their spirit, you know, their everything. And I'll hear this. I'll hear people saying this on different groups. You know, I do admin from time to time on an alien abduction support group, and in other places, you'll see me kind of go through and chime in. But people will say, well, you know, they're here to steal our souls, and that's a really scary thing to say to anyone, because if there's something that people hold dear above, you know, their dog or their red Corvette or their mom or their dad or their children, is the idea that there could be a being that could steal one's soul. And in 25 years of and lots of hypnotic regression and lots of spiritual work, I really want to come down to it and say there's really literally nothing that I've seen, although I did fear this at one point, that can steal somebody's soul. And it seems like part of this confusion comes about because there are a lot of different teachers and different healing cults and mediumistic cults and spiritual cults that are teaching a very convoluted and difficult systems of becoming clairvoyant, clairaudient, clairsentient, doing mediumship, doing healing. And they have a lot of controls built into their systems, which lead to a kind of hierarchy within their groups. And I wanted to say something about, look, if you're looking for good spiritual training, it should be rather simple. You want to avoid things that contain built-in hierarchies, built-in judgments, you're not there yet because you haven't developed this, that, or the other thing, someone saying that to you, and things that make and things that embrace your entire beingness on the spiritual path. So, and when you find this kind of better spiritual teaching, what you'll also find is sort of comfort that, you know what, you are here by divine right. Your soul is yours. There is nothing and no one that can take it away from you. And your spirit is also, even though it's less of your personality and it's closer to, quote-unquote, the creator, your spirit is also something that you have by inalienable right, by divine right. It's yours. Nothing will take it away from you. The only things that we lose here in the spirit, in the physical realm, are our physical bodies, and eventually, at some point, we will move on from the personalities that we develop in these physical bodies. So don't be afraid. There's a lot of stuff going on in the universe, but the things that are innately yours, which are the spiritual you, your spirit, your soul, your personality, unfortunately, you'll lose your body. We all will. But all of these things are innately yours, and no being from any planet or any realm is capable of taking them from you or stealing them for you, or taking out a big needle and, you know, sucking them out of your body or anything like that. So that would be the first thing. But it becomes a very real fear because for alien experiencers, because the physical fear can be so overwhelming. And just the affront to the worldview, our personalities as they form are very tightly wound within the worldview that we're given to work within. And so we may experience a sort of personality ego death because our worldview is greatly, greatly challenged by the existence of physical alien beings who can cause us not to be able to move, who can cause us to see visions, who can read our minds, who can put us into alternate virtual reality situations and gauge our reactions. All of these sort of psychological things that can happen are very challenging to the personality and very challenging to the ego. So, you know, I make no guarantees about people not have an ego death when they come across aliens, or even a group of aliens, or even a bunch of aliens out in the middle of the desert, like the Gifford song. Because basically, you know, you may very well have an ego death of one kind or another, and it may be quite a dramatic display of your personality and your worldview, basically getting sucked right out of your body, but your soul and your spirit are all going to be intact, and you know, you don't need to worry about those things. But your ego, it's shamanic, and that's what John Mack used to say. So you think this is a shamanic thing, and I never knew what he was talking about. Well, what he was talking about was the ego death, the personality being so greatly challenged that the personality that had the ego, that thought certain things were real and certain things were important and certain things were what you lived for, just kind of, you know, going, oh my gosh, none of this is real, it's not important, and I was living for something I don't even care about anymore. So that can happen, and that often does happen. But spiritually, you're going to be okay. And everybody is, and you don't need to join any particular religious faith. You don't need to call on any particular religious being unless it makes you feel better. But you know, nothing's going to happen to your soul or your spirit. It's all going to be there, and you're not going to forget the personality that you were before. Before you knew more, before you were greatly, greatly, greatly challenged, you'll remember who you were, what you thought about things, how you felt about things. You'll just see things differently because you've evolved through your learning experience. Your perception of reality evolves through what's been thrown at you through your physical world learning experience. So anyway, I think the Mojave incident is really about what happens with the Giffords in terms of all of this. And, you know, though somebody may be screaming, you know, they want to steal my soul, you know, different people react to different things in different ways. For example, I lived out in the middle of nowhere with no aliens around, but there were a lot of tree spirits. And my sister walked into the guest cabin and a tree spirit followed her in, and she got terrified of the tree spirit. So, you know, if you're faced with something you don't know about or you're not familiar with, it can seem awfully, awfully scary and threatening until you become aware of what it is, what it wants, what its motivations are. And basically, this tree spirit was just asking her, you don't have any intention of chopping down the trees, do you? And the answer was no, she didn't. So everything was good. But there's spiritual intelligence all over the universe. And when you become clairaudient, clairvoyant, clairsentient, you can also smell things clearly and have other clear senses. You're going to find yourself faced with those intelligence trying to communicate with you in the ways that they do. And it's a good idea to, have already gone through your trial by fear, which is often done in the alien abduction scenario and the alien contact scenario. Because there really is not much more that's scarier than not being able to move your body, or not being able to, or having a virtual reality experience, or having your mind manipulated for a short period of time. That's about as scary as it gets. So after that, you know, other intelligences, piece of cake, people, piece of cake. You'll be right on top of it. So that's all I get to say about that. Getting over fear is a good thing, but it's really your physical body and your personality and your worldview that are most in danger from anything that happens on the physical plane. But they're the things that are also in danger from your alien abduction experiences. You can be physically hurt during an alien abduction experience. Your personality can be greatly challenged. You can come out of it. Some people come out of these things with borderline personality disorder. Some people come out, you know, being a little bit twitchy and schizoaffective. You know, it's not more than the norm for the general population, you know, 2% or so, but something that's so stressful can lead to difficult times, and difficult times look like psychopathology sometimes when they're not. So anyway.
Yeah, that's interesting.
That's all I got to say about that, James Tyson.
That's all I got to say about that. It's post-traumatic stress you come out of. Like huge PTSD.
Yeah.
And that's how, actually it's the Hess family that the book, the Mojave Incident is based on. And at the time he was writing the book, they hadn't really come public with that part of it yet. They were still like, no, don't be using a real name and things like that, which you could imagine, because they were still literally dealing with therapy and trying to understand what had happened. And coming to grips, even with what the psychologist had told them, because in reality they weren't sure what they had. You know, was it carbon monoxide poisoning? Did we eat some bad meat or something? That kind of thing.
Right.
Was it food poisoning? Well, if they're both put under hypnosis, and they're both comment.
You still there?
Yeah, I'm still here. Hold on a second here. I'll see if I'm still here. Yeah, I'm here. If they're both actually recalling the same incident at the same time, then you can't be sick to have two people recall that. So, and that's where they come out of it going, okay, crap, this really wasn't a environmental issue. And what I mean by environmental, they didn't get food poisoning, they weren't common monoxide, carbon dioxide, any effects of something that was out and around where they were, because two people separately, even if they're on LSD, they will not be able to look at a tree, and if it's growing an arm, they do not both see a tree grow an arm. They both have individual experiences because they have individual personalities, individual minds, complete individual upbringing, and, well, call it programming. So to see something separate like that is exactly what it is. And it is something paranormal. And unfortunately, that's what they were seeing. Which then brings it back on them as, holy crap, this was real. And if it was real, then what exactly did we see? And I'm not, my puny little human brain is not prepared for this. Which most of our little human puny brains aren't prepared for something like that. Well, I know mine isn't. And that is something that, you know, I talk to my puny human brain about quite often. Just telling it to pay attention and smarten up. Listen to your gut as opposed to try to hook up to something that's going on and trying to think your way through it, because you're not going to in something like that. It's going to be coming down on you so hard and so fast. Well, I think I may have lost young Elizabeth forever, which isn't bad. Oh, hold on. Could you hear me say that? Well, let's hope not. Because that would have... She's a witch.
Hey there.
So... Oh, crap. Hi, how are you?
I'm a what?
No, I said witch. I mean, it wasn't a... No. I was saying awfully nice things. Or actually, I was saying awful things about you. No, I was saying good things.
If I were a nice witch, if I were a better witch, I'd make Skype work. I'd just like snap my fingers.
Are you a good witch or a bad witch?
I'm a sandwich.
Yeah.
The very bad witch. I can't make my Skype work.
So, yeah. Okay, so what are you selling in your little shop down in Nuevo Mexico?
In Nuevo Mexico? I sell fine art by a fine artist named Laura Balambini, who has
artsy?
An interesting... She's a good artist, and I sell fine art, landscape photography, pictures in different formats, and
cool.
A lot of jewelry. I don't read tarot cards. I should say that I do, but I do sell them, because when I was up in Telluride, everybody wanted to buy their tarot cards from me, and I'm like, really? But I have tarot cards. I have some of my books, and I have some... various gemstone, energized gemstone jewelry and purses and clothing. And my cat basically, she grabs everybody who comes through the door and tells them they have to pet her. So right now it seems like I'm selling a cat, but she's just trying to get petted. So
petted?
That's some.
Yeah,
she likes to be petted.
Petted?
She likes
attention, is what she likes.
She likes attention. She likes to greet everybody at the door, and she's like, meow, pet me. And people are like, is she friendly? Because the way she meows, it's so like, it's meow, and it's really, do pet me. And then she's fine. So I think right now I'm just sort of, one lady today spent like 5 minutes hugging my cat.
Aw, so that should be like $10.
I know, cat therapy.
Cat therapy.
You know, you've had a hard...
Oh, don't start that, because... You'll end up starting an entire new age fad, and you'll just frighten me from that point on.
I'll be the really strange cat lady in the gallery with all of the therapy cats.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a cat lady. A cat lady gone wild. Can just wait till midnight when I get to watch Cat Lady Gone Wild on those odd channels. Come on, grab the popcorn. Look at this. It's cat wait. Oh, hold on. It's a real cat lady.
It's for all those people with post-traumatic stress.
You know what? Honestly, you aren't crazy, are you? You're married, right?
No, so I am not married.
You're single.
So okay. I'm really not crazy because I'm not married.
Okay,
I've been in long-term relationships, but I am not married.
Okay, and you have cats.
So. I have two cats.
And you walk around the house barefoot.
Yes, I am barefoot.
Yeah. See,
how did you know that?
I'm psychopathic. I can read your mind. all right. That's a generalization and a half, isn't it? Oh, you're single and you have cats? Oh, then you must be insane and walk around your house barefoot.
I only have two cats because the cat
the other
who likes...
seven were taken away from you?
No, because one didn't like to hunt for mice, and up in Colorado we had a mouse problem, so I went to the shelter and picked the one I thought would be the best mouser, and she was. So, but she's also, she's a nice cat, but she will hunt mice. The older one will not hunt mice. That's beneath her. Oh. So.
That's beneath her. I have someone else who hunts my mice for me.
Well, yes.
That's just great. I'll put a cat. Okay, this is just...
We've talked about the point of
cat ladies. Hey, now, of course, and my listener knows that you experienced a very traumatic incident with extraterrestrials. How old were you when that happened?
I have a lifetime of traumatic experiences with extraterrestrials.
Okay, first time, how old were you?
32. The first one that I remember, I was 3, but I'm pretty sure that they were taking my mom when I was in the womb, and I really affected her badly. So I had some regressions, sort of, rebirthing regressions, not by John Mack, through another source, and I remember sort of being like, wow, okay, I'm not in the cold, dark place anymore, and who are those guys? And my mom had a terrible time with me in the womb. But the first one I remember, one of my earliest memories was 3 years old.
And when you say an early memory, what was that memory like at 3?
There were these bad men who were little gray men with gray robes on, and they were holding a gun to my father's head, and I was screaming, saying, no, don't shoot my daddy, no, you can do anything you want to me, just don't shoot my daddy, because they were holding one of their guns to his head. And a moment later, the gun went off, there was this flash of light, but it wasn't like a gun, it was like a space-age kind of gun.
A ray gun.
Yeah, the flash of light happened, and the next thing I knew, I was hitting my bed really hard, like when you wake up really hard, it's like, boom, mm-hmm. And I was running into my mom's bedroom. My dad was actually at Berkeley in California. He was studying botany. He was getting a master's degree in botany. And I went looking in for him and my mom's in their bedroom, but he was away at school. And I was just hysterical. And my mom couldn't get me to stop crying. And then she tried to call him to get him on the phone so he could tell me he was okay, and she couldn't get him. Well, he was being abducted in California at the same time. He was on a field trip, and the bus broke down, and they missed a little over 9 hours of time. So, so it was within the same 24-hour period. He didn't say what time of day the bus broke down, but I think it was just before nightfall, and that they didn't wake up and find themselves back in the bus until the morning. And he saw a little craft on this mountain pass road, in the Sierras to the east of San Francisco. So, yeah, so that was my first experience. He left school. He didn't get his master's degree. He came home and he tried to protect me. It didn't work. So, it was kind of sad.
Amazing.
For him.
So it started with your mother, or did your grandparents, or did you know if you're any generations before?
We think my mother may have been, but she had some form of brain damage. But my grandfather, my father, myself, we know that my dad's father had seen a ship in the road, and he lived in northern Alabama, and there was a back way to go from his house to Hackleburg, Alabama, from Hamilton, and it cut off 40 miles of a drive, and then he was abducted from that road, and he never drove it again. He went the 40 miles around because he had such a traumatic experience, he would never drive down that road. And my dad talked to John Mack and related experiences from the time he was 3 years old that he remembered and knew about and had conscious memory of and had just never told anybody.
Who's John Mack? So,
he was a psychiatrist, an MD psychiatrist, who was a faculty member at Harvard School of Medicine, who decided to get involved in alien abduction research in 1990. And he was brought into it by Bud Hopkins. And he was brought in because he had done some holotropic breath work with Stan Grof and had some interesting experiences himself. And then one of the guys that was in his holotropic breath work group was talking about bringing up an alien abduction in the holotropic breathwork work. And then somehow, and he knew Bud Hopkins. This person knew Bud Hopkins. And the person asked if Bud Hopkins could talk to John, and Bud did. So, do you know who Bud Hopkins is, everybody?
I don't.
Oh, my goodness. He was kind of the original alien abduction researcher, at least the most kind of famous one, who came out with a book in 1987, I think, called Intruders. He worked with lots and lots of people on the East Coast.
Yeah. Okay, so he...
There was like Leo Sprinkle. It kind of goes, to my mind, the most known... Leo Sprinkle was probably first most known, then Bud Hopkins. John Mack was the most academic... and the one the media and PsyCop wanted to take out of the picture, so they did a big trashing campaign. And then, and then after John Mack kind of was just beset on all sides, people were afraid to stand up and say, well, I'm an alien abduction researcher.
Yeah, no kidding.
It kind of fell out of sections then, so.
Yeah, they have a way of... kicking you pretty hard when you're coming out like that.
Yeah.
Let's shut this guy up by saying he's crazy.
Well, what they did is they sent somebody in to lie, and then because he even listened to her, he didn't use her in his research, but he did allow her to have a session, but he didn't use any of her information in any of the research that was presented. She went to PsyCop and said, well, he couldn't even tell that I was lying. Well, he could. He didn't use your information in any of the research findings. But you presented yourself as a friend from a higher-up of MUFON. And so, politically speaking, he was damned if he didn't work with you. And personally speaking, he was damned if he did work with you. So,
The Mac gentleman, somebody cog in the chat was wanting me to ask you if you know anything about his death.
I do. He was hit by a driver in London, in a suburb of London. He was crossing a street outside of a tube stop. The thing is that where he was crossing, they said it was a kind of a blind curve, but I went to that spot, and there was a lot of room for him to cross safely and for people to see him. My feeling is, when I scanned the person who hit him, is that there was a kind of astral interference with the driver, where the driver was... interfered with from the astral plane, maybe by somebody doing remote influencing in black ops or something to that effect. The driver did not hit him on purpose, and the driver was not incredibly drunk you know, people go to the pub a lot in England, but this driver was not thoroughly inebriated or anything like that, and there was a lot of space for him to slow down. And what they said was it was a blind curb, blah, 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 blah. But if you actually go to the place, you can see the curve, and you can see there's a lot of space, and you can see it's fairly open. So something must have happened both to Dr. Mack and to the driver, that the driver just barreled right into him and didn't slow down at the intersection, which had a crosswalk. So he was hit in the crosswalk. But he was also, you know, getting ready to wrap up all of his alien abduction research and archive it, and he had started to get involved more with political campaigning, and, you know, he was getting ready to retire. He was 74, so it just so happened that he got hit, and he died right away, and, you know, he didn't have time to retire, which I think would be hard for him. He was a really hard worker.
Well, he retired in a different way.
Yeah, he retired to spirit.
Yeah, and
he's still quite executive. I still hear from him from time to time. He's usually a very short, you know, do this. It's like, oh, hi, John, do this. Okay, fine. Yeah, but
yeah. So you think, like, when you said you scanned the driver, tell me what that means.
Well, I can do a fair bit of remote viewing, and I can be, you know, front-loaded without too much trouble. And it's just, you know, having a target. So my target is the driver, just to look and see what his state of mind was, what's going on around him. And there were dark forms in the astral plane around him, and he did not appear to be drunk or too drunk, and but it just seemed like a blind spot, you know. Mm-hmm. It seemed like all of a sudden there was a sort of cognitive blind spot that was created as John Mack was crossing the road, and I think it was from the astral plane, and I think it might have been remotely influenced, but we don't know. But definitely the person himself did not have any desire to hit John Mack or, you know, take him out or anything like that. There's none of that.
So
there,
it wasn't a conscious effort by somebody thinking, okay, he's out drinking with his buddies, it's 11 something at night, and I'm going to wait, and he's going to cross here, and I'll accelerate and run him over. Which is it works on TV, and it takes a long time to actually set up, because we did have a guy try to kill his wife that way, and you're interfered with by a number of things, like other traffic shows up where the wife doesn't cross where you think she's going to cross, and there's all sorts of other forces at play when you're not supposed to kill somebody, so they usually will screw you up. Yeah, it's interesting. You know, thanks, Cog, for the question. That was, I didn't know much about that at all. That is a relatively odd story about a fellow who was that well connected in at so many levels in these things.
Well, you know, what was interesting is that two of the original four abductees in the support group, one was also murdered, and the other were not sure. He developed very quickly a killing disease, cardiopulmonary hypertension. And, you know, it might have just been something he was set up for, but his best friend, who had spoken to the media, who was in, who was quoted in Psychology Today and some other publications, he was actually murdered, and we know this. And we don't know if there was any payoff for the person who did it. We do know that the person who did it got away with it, but we're not sure if there was, you know, some backdoor dealing on her part to, you know, did somebody pay her? She was very interested in money, and so there could have been, but we're not sure. So, you know, it could have just been wrong place, wrong time, too. You know, coincidence is not or correlation is not causation, but we don't.
So. Sorry, I love it when people say stuff like that.
Correlation, it isn't, but yet it's a little odd. That they both died young, both died within the decade that they were doing alien abduction research at a very high level. Cog, we could get into the whole, like, you know, are you safe? Are you not safe if you try to do disclosure? But it's, you just do the best that you can.
Yeah, no kidding.
Hope people are nice.
Oh, people are always nice. Except the crazy ones.
Yeah.
And if they were always nice, I'd be at work as a policeman. So, just one of those things.
Yeah. Well, anyway. Yeah. So post-traumatic stress, you kind of have to be crazy if you have it, because, like, one of the things that came about for me is that I had a ton of post-traumatic stress from lots and lots and lots of experiences, and I really love, like, regressive hypnotherapy, and I love going to do holotropic breathwork, and which is kind of it's a self-regressive kind of hypnotherapy. I love that kind of stuff, and other people will get all upset by their traumas, and I'm all, oh man, it was 6 traumas. You know, it was like, I went through this and I went through that and I went through that other thing, and I was like, and now they're gone. So you know, if you are an experiencer, you might want to embrace reliving your trauma, because of course that's an individual thing. Never mind. Just saying.
Never mind. I was ranting on a etheric level.
Well, if you have a lot of post-traumatic stress, you know you feel better after you do therapy if you've done enough of it. But if you don't, for some people who I call them wimps, they haven't had much wrong happen. Sometimes these therapies can just be really uncomfortable for them. You know, holotropic breathwork can be uncomfortable for people who don't have a lot of trauma, because they don't have a lot of trauma. Why do they want to remember it?
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah,
I've got post-traumatic stress from completely other issues related to work. And, you know, going to a psychologist who would just nod and say, you'll see you next week, didn't really help.
It doesn't help at all.
Going to a psychic who said, this is how it's all going to turn out and you're going to be fine, went, oh, I'm not stressed anymore at all. Because that's what it was.
Yeah.
It was triggers, and those things don't trigger me anymore. I kind of laugh them off.
Right. You know, if somebody can tell you, oh yeah, that's just triggering you, or if you get used to your triggers, like you flood yourself with triggers, you can see them coming. Or if you relive the situation that triggered you, or the multiple situations that trigger you, eventually they just become nothing, and it's, you know, for being an alien abductee who went through several years of really stupendous fear and having to drink myself to sleep every night, and then only sleeping 2 or 2.5 or 3 hours a night, it's really great to, you know, be able to walk around in the middle of the dark and people are saying, aren't you going to step on a snake? And it's like, I don't effing care, because I'm not afraid. You know, it's like,
if I'm lucky, the snake will kill me. Yeah.
I'm not afraid. No, there's no snake out here. I'm psychic. I know I'd feel it if there was a snake, you know, but it's, you know, I'm not going to walk into an alien, or I'm not going to be afraid that one's peeking around a corner at me anymore. You know, I'm going to be whisked off to somewhere without being able to say anything about it. So that's a great thing about, if you have post-traumatic stress, regressive hypnotherapy is really good. Holotropic breathwork is really good, because you can go about your life and not have to drink yourself to sleep. Or
no, you can use opiates.
Or use opiates.
Oh, it's, I've got a pain. I have a real pain, and that's why I take fentanyl until I die in my elevator. Yeah,
I'm terribly afraid. So yes,
I'm so afraid. Yeah, it's speaking of fentanyl, we get a lot of dead people around here because of that right now. So
What is fentanyl? I don't
fentanyl
even know.
Fentanyl is a it's an artificial opiate. And that's it's so you don't have to bring heroin in from different countries for the drug dealer or drug addicts around here. You could, you know, one little pill of fentanyl could, you know, supply what you used to have to supply with half a unit of heroin. But the unfortunate part is that people don't know how to mix it because they're drug dealers and people are, their users are overdosing left and right here. Because the heroin shipments are basically, the heroin here is, everything seems to be, we're out of heroin, let's say. I guess those damn Afghans aren't doing their job. The what has that war done to our heroin supply? Good Lord. I know there's people out there saying, well, you just have to get hold of the DEA. They'll ship it to you. Well, smart enough. Heroin supply is really curtailed. Mexican heroin, same with that. But a lot of the heroin dealers or users here won't be using tar heroin. They'll be using like powdered Chinese heroin, which is where we got it from, primarily is China. And now fentanyl, we're getting fentanyl from the Chinese too, because they're supplying all the chemicals to make it. And I guess it's, you know, it is a, I think it's a legitimate drug, but that's what Prince died of. He died of a fentanyl overdose.
Was using it for the right purpose. I mean,
it's a painkiller. It's, you know, honestly, our heroin problem here on the coast really started, it grew out of the opium dens that were legal here and opium imports. But because we're a logging fishing area out here, I'm still here. There was a, you know, these guys would come in from the forest with a broken back or screwed up hip. And back in the day, doctors weren't really prescribing them anything. Yes, I'm here. Unless I've gone completely off.
Oh, you're here.
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, we're getting a little fuzzy, but it's also getting to be that time.
It is. We're at 7 minutes late, but I'll just finish my thought about heroin here, is that a lot of the construction and lumber industry guys were retired. They didn't have any medical, and they had incredible bone and like back issues from working in the lumber industry hard for years. And they started using, they started self-medicating on opiates, opium. And when they couldn't get opium anymore, they switched on to heroin, and that's kind of where it started here.
Wow.
As opposed to like Civil War, where basically it was invented as a replacement for people being addicted to morphine. They thought, well, this is a new drug. We'll make sure.
Morphine's good stuff. I had morphine once.
Yeah, it is.
I broke my back and I had morphine for like, I had three pushes from.
Lovely. we lost her again because she's back on morphine. I was addicted to Demerol. I had knee surgery, and they sent me home after like an injection every 4 hours. And I curled up on the floor. I was 16, curling up on the floor in this, where the sun comes through under the carpet, and just in the fetal position, shaking. And I didn't know why. I went to my doctor and told him, and he said, "Oh, you're just addicted to Demerol. Yeah, you were going through withdrawals." And I'm 16 going, I don't really think you're supposed to do that. Are you? That's what I was thinking. I wasn't saying it out loud. Bizarre. Now if they give me Demerol, I found out that I have an interesting reaction to it. As soon as I smell food, if I'm on Demerol, I begin projection vomiting. Which is kind of embarrassing if you are trying to be the cool teenager in the hospital. Not that I ever was the cool teenager in the hospital. We are sneaking up to that time. I bet you young Elizabeth may or may not come back in here because she's probably strangling her cat again. I bet you the cat was chewing on her Skype wires again.
No.
No. No?
No, she wasn't.
Okay.
No, but I am going to do the spiel because I think it's time for me to get going anyway.
Okay, do your thing.
I am Elizabeth Anglin, your host before the host, even though the host was here, because my Skype was wonky again. And you are listening to Spaced Out Radio, where all sorts of good things are happening. There are going to be free books from Ron Felber. Especially if you are a space traveler, once we get our group going with a newsletter. And if you want to find me in a nice way, look online, elizabethanglin.com. You can send me a message, sign up to get a reading of one sort or another. I am not a drug dealer. Just so you know, I'm not a heroin pusher nor a morphine fiend. And that being said, I'm going to sign out and let Ron Felber take over James.
Thanks very much, Elizabeth. And you take care of yourself. And don't keep breaking your back every 2 weeks just to get some morphine. That's just crazy talk.
More.
I will talk to you tomorrow night at 9 p.m. out here on the left coast and midnight on the other side of the planet. Okay. The East Coast.
All right.
Okay. Have a good night.
All right. See you later. Bye.
I'm going to go make my tea. I'll be right back with Ron Felber. Ron Felber. Soon. Catch you in a few seconds.
It's time to go live on Spaced Out Weekend.
Thirteen, please. Oh, hi, Kevin. Oh, is that the time? Kevin, my friend, don't you find that watch just a little bit loud? Well, I certainly hope our buddy Bumblefoot is playing when we get there. Oh, you stinky big bundle of hair. I said Bumblefoot, not Bigfoot. Oh, it's going to be a long night.
It's time to head to the 13th floor of the Old Log Cabin for Spaced Out Weekend with James Tyson. You can tweet James at James Tyson SOR. You can find him on Instagram, Spaced Out Weekend, as well as on Facebook. On YouTube, our channel is Spaced Out Radio Show, and you can check out our website, spacedoutradio.com.
Little brother has taken control, shoveling dirt in every hole. Predators to condemn your soul, watching you and watching me. We're all connected but separated, misunderstood and so frustrated. A million armies of one have invaded, watching you and watching me. With this behind glass curtains and act like nothing's wrong, soon you will belong. I know you're out there somewhere. We've watched you for so long. Wait for you to fall. We'll expose you all. I know you're out there somewhere. Watch it back.
Ladies and gentlemen, the story you are about to see is true. The names have been changed to protect the innocent.
And now, perched high in his captain's chair, way above the clouds, here's James Tyson.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Spaced Out Weekend. Yes, it is me, James Tyson, still broadcasting from my little log cabin on the 13th floor of the Spaced Out Radio Network here on the paranormal portals of the lower left Canadian coast. And tonight with us, we have author Ron Felber. Now, Ron is the author of the Jack Madison crime thrillers, A Man of Indeterminate Value, The Kafka Society, and his newest one, Dark Angel. His nonfiction books include The Mojave Incident and Il Dottore, The Double Life of a Mafia Doctor, which was actually the base for a movie. Was it a movie or a series?
It was a series. a television series.
Yeah, and that is kind of cool when you start getting your books picked up for things like that. Now, it was The Mob Doctor, for those who follow along and are watching through all the cool shows on Fox television. It was a drama called The Mob Doctor, and that was Ron's book. It was the base for that. He's a graduate of Georgetown University, teaches creative writing at Drew's University, Casperson School of Graduate Studies in New Jersey. His book, The Mojave Incident, is we're going to start with that, but it's been picked up for an hour in October on Paranormal Witness. And his book, I'm going to call it a book at this point. He has a book, The Hunt for Kunsa. It's a Burmese drug lord. Now, that is being picked up for a look at Netflix. So if you ever see this coming out, and we're going to probably mention it when it does come out, The Hunt for Kunsa, it's about a Burmese drug lord. Well, that's Ron's writing. He got to travel to Burma, and we're going to talk to him about that. And again, Dark Angel is newest into a screenplay right now, and there's an option picked up from a studio on that. It's incredible. You've been bouncing all over the place, Ron. Welcome back to Spaced Out Weekend.
Thanks, James. Good to be here.
And I really will get that word indeterminate figured out. It's one of those things when you
wouldn't be the first that had problems with it.
My dyslexia on some words, it was terrible when I was a policeman reading a license plate and the dispatcher would pause and say, "Okay, James, could you do that again?"
I said, "Well, yeah, right.
ABC 123. No, that car doesn't exist." And I go, "Oh, yeah, right." I get mad at her, then realize it was completely backwards. So we talked a while ago about the Mojave incident. I want to get back into that a little bit, and then we're going to move into this new fiction book, Dark Angel, which sounds really interesting. But let's start off with who the heck are you? What got you into writing, and all of a sudden you're seem to be a star of television and Netflix and film?
You know, it's really a funny business. The arts are just a funny business to begin with. I suppose singers would say the same thing, or dancers, or any kind of, you know, art, people that are in the field of art, whether it's writing or movie making. It's very up and down. And so, you know, I started writing in the sixth grade. You know, a teacher said, you know, you have a very unique way of putting things and a very unique perspective on things. So I took that as a compliment, and I started writing short stories. I had my first book published in 1977, believe it or not, when I was, you know, maybe 19. And then from there, I branched out. But it has been books, and all of a sudden, I would say since the last time I talked to you, so maybe you're just good luck for me, James. But everything, really, all hell broke loose. I suddenly got a call from out of the blue from Living Films, which is the biggest film producer in Southeast Asia. And I said, well, you know, this book, The Hunt for Kunsa, is a wonderful book. And we're very interested in, you know, making a television series out of it. This book was written in something like 2009. So I really wasn't expecting, you know, this to happen, but it did. So they purchased an option, and they purchased the rights, and now they're looking at a 10 one-hour TV shows, you know, in a series. Same wow. with Dark Angel, pretty much the same. It's these things sort of come out of the blue. Same with Paranormal Witness and the Sci-Fi Channel. You know, Mojave Incident was number one on Amazon for quite some time. And it had come out previously, a number of years before that, and did very poorly. So the reprint, the reprint of a book that was kind of a failure, became a bestseller. Next thing I know, these, you know, people are contacting me, and you know, indirectly through publishers and whatnot, finally got a hold of me, and said, you know, we want to do an hour show on this book. I said, fine. So, I mean, that's the way it goes. But this has been a long, long journey, I have to tell you.
Yeah, it sounds like it. Holy cow. But, you know, we've had a change, a shift in consciousness when it comes to speaking out loud about things that you never really talked about. You know, if you had an uncle who maybe said you saw a UFO, that's crazy Uncle Ted. We won't mention the UFO, okay, because it'll just get him rambling. it's become more mainstream, and we're not overly afraid to mention it and say it out loud anymore. And as more people are kind of coming out of the paranormal closet, those kind of books are what they're looking at. And they're going back 30, 40, 50 years into some books and writings of people in the paranormal and the psychic phenomena and things like that. So it doesn't surprise me that a book like the Mojave Incident was reborn, kind of, you know, coming off the back of the shelf, dusted off and back into the mainstream. And look what that has started. Like now someone's shining a flashlight onto Ron Felber sitting at his desk typing and going, "Oh, look at all the other stuff he's got coming out."
Yeah, no, it's a great feeling, frankly. And you know, from my standpoint, long overdue, but better late than never. But you know, I do want to comment on people coming out, as you say.
Yeah.
I couldn't agree more. I think that you know, there's a huge phenomenon going on worldwide. And you can see it just in the United States, for example, in the politics. People have almost given up on institutions. They don't trust governments. They don't have the belief they once did in many religions, organized religions. They don't believe in corporations because they've seen, you know, their friends laid off and cutbacks and this and that. And so I think people are really searching. They used to say, well, reality is this corporation that I work for. Reality is this corporation that I work for plus this church that I go to. And by the way, of course, we all believe in the government. If you take those things away, there's a change in the seabed, the fundamental basis of people's beliefs and thoughts. And so I think they turn to other things and say, if this isn't reality, what is reality?
Yeah. And you're getting more of those people that are kind of anti-government, not violent anti-government, but more of the conspiracy.
Of course, yeah.
Some get a little bit over paranoid, but they're examining the government, and we're looking at it with a skeptical eye as opposed to just nodding and doing, you know, what we've always done, kind of wandered like sheep.
I think that's true, but I also think that just people generally either need or certainly want a basis, a launching pad to launch their life off of and their family's lives off of. And I think that's, you know, that's been sort of missing for a while. And I think people are really now open to saying with quantum physics, you know, the breakthroughs in quantum physics, et cetera, well, why isn't it possible? Why couldn't it be that we've been visited by alien craft or alien beings? Why is that so outrageous? You know, and they start to figure out it isn't so outrageous. As a matter of fact, the probabilities are quite high.
Yeah, and the more people that have a curiosity in that field, the more we all kind of have a collective investigation, let's say. We all start looking at it with the modern tools. You've got all these paranormal kind of ghost hunters running around. It started many, many years ago with recorders, and now they've got forward-looking infrared. They've got all sorts of not night vision per se, but yeah, infrared and full spectrum cameras. And we've kind of increased this technology because of our curiosity in that. Just as we've been increasing our technology in our curiosity of the cosmos.
Absolutely. And I also think it's a two-way street. I mean, if you're asking me what I think that probably there is a civilization or civilizations that have been trying to make contact for quite some time. I mean, if you look at the original UFO reports, you know, you'd see something in Life magazine, a black and white fuzzy picture. Some guy took a picture outside of the plane through the window, and you see in the mountains this sort of object and say, you know, what could this be? And somebody names it a flying saucer. So that would be something in the late 50s or so. Then you have Betty and Barney Hill in the early 60s with the first abduction case. But again, it's pretty vague. They have no memory. It has to be recovered through, you know, retrogressive hypnosis. But now, with the Phoenix Lights, for example, where people are actually videotaping, you know, UFOs, when thousands of people are observing them, air pilots, astronauts, you know, policemen, et cetera, it starts to get more pushed forward, too. It's not just that people are more receptive to it. The message is getting much clearer. And if you look at the Mojave incident and the alien abduction story of the Giffords, and their real names are Steve and Dawn Hess, you see that this has come to a point where there are communications. There's millions of people worldwide that say they've been abducted and have been encountered and tested on and communicated with alien beings. So I think it's a two-way street. People are more receptive on the one hand, but on the other hand, I think that the observations have become much clearer and much more dramatic.
Yeah, it is amazing, and it's becoming almost with the social media, the extent of social media, which has its you know, like anything else, there's a negative and a positive to it. We get a lot of information out there relatively quick, and you know, it's open for everybody's interpretation. And we get the naysayers saying, you know, it's not real, or we'll always get the person writing in and quoting something in the Bible that we're going to die, and which is, you know, fair enough. It's, you know, freedom of speech, but you know, they're still trying
James,
to push.
You don't think you and I are going to die, do you?
Well, I will never die. This body's going to eventually.
That's the spirit
fade
that won
away.
The West.
Yeah. I'll be finished with this body in a few decades. But after that, I'm sure I'm going to get a new one. But you know, they're still trying to push our heads down, away from that. And but there's more and more people breaking through that. They're not taking the crap that the skeptics are throwing
out. And when presidents start reporting UFOs, Jimmy Carter in the 70s when he was a governor before becoming president, you know, made an official UFO report with 10 people coming out of a meeting. He watched with 9 other people a UFO and actually reported it, which is pretty amazing, because here's a guy that really his background is nuclear engineering. Then you get Fife Symington, who is governor of Arizona. Initially, during the Phoenix flight, he denied, you know, he made fun of the people, his own constituency, by the way, made fun of these people that claimed they saw these UFOs. But then 10 years later, he did an interview with CNN that is stunning, and it's on the internet. Fife Symington, governor of Arizona, just YouTube, where he says that he did that for political reasons, but the truth is, and now he wanted to tell it, was that he and his son saw a craft the size of a football field hover over them for about 3 minutes and then take off at an incredible speed. He said it was like a floating fortress. He also said, as a former fighter pilot in Vietnam, he was very familiar with the kinds of craft the U.S. Army and military would have, and there was nothing even close that could resemble what he saw. Now, that's pretty stunning stuff, you know?
Oh, yeah. And, you know, coming from somebody with that background, and that's what you kind of look at. You look at those people with the background. In Canada, we have Paul Hellyer, who was an engineer, politician, writer. He was member of the Privy Council, which is, if you were an officer, you kind of get, if you're going to be a commissioned officer, it goes to the Privy Council. They do all sorts of cool things. He was a cabinet minister, and he speaks out now, retired, because that was back in the 60s and 70s. He's probably near 80 some years old. He was the assistant to the Minister of National Defense in Canada. And he is out there all the time now pushing disclosure and pushing government for more transparency on, we'll call it, the UFO issue, because he's out there doing, like, he had access to those files, let's just put it that way.
Sure.
The ones from 47. So he's on the circuit right now doing talks about it and his experiences. But, you know, you are fighting. And my big argument is disclosure is great for all the people who believe. But we've got it. We're all playing for that, the dumbest person on the, when you're out for a run with your teammates, you're always kind of running with the slowest person, trying to, you know, keep person involved in the team. Yeah. Unfortunately, we're still dumbing down to that guy who's building a bunker and wearing a tinfoil hat and loading it with, with guns because, heck, the Syrian refugees are coming. Now we're going to add aliens to that.
Sure. Well, I was really pleased at the reception that the Mojave incident got, and you know, thanks to talk shows like yours, I mean, it really is doing very well, and I'm sure very appreciative. One anecdote that I found that I thought was very interesting in the research for the Mojave incident was Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan on Air Force One observed a UFO. He mentioned it a couple of times, and a couple of people reported it, you know, in minor detail. However, just when he was governor and running for president, so let's say the end of his tenure as governor, he and his wife apparently were invited to William Holden, the actor's house, for a cocktail party. So Lucille Ball was there as well. And writes in her autobiography this little account. She says that the Reagans showed up about 2 hours late, which is very, very unlike them, made apologies, and then Ronald Reagan proceeded to tell the group that he and Nancy had seen a UFO, that they followed it towards Bakersfield for quite some time, that it hovered very close to them, and then took off at an incredible speed over the ocean. And that's why they were 2 hours late. But you know, that's a great story, I think. But beyond that, isn't it interesting? And I really wonder if Ronald Reagan didn't have missing time. I really wonder if he was hypnotized, if he didn't have an alien abduction experience. I know that maybe sounds a little over the edge, but if you take that story at its face, and let's say, why would Lucille Ball, you know, make that up for an autobiography, it really has huge consequences, because Reagan's also the guy that addressed the UN and said, you know, what would happen if an alien force, an alien came to this universe? It would unite all the peoples of the world. He actually made that speech. They tried to cut it out, his advisors, but he insisted that it be in. Isn't that interesting?
Oh, it's fascinating. And Marianne Morgan, who's been on the show, she's a psychic. She was a psychic for and knew the Reagans.
Uh-huh.
She said they were very open to any metaphysical or paranormal or extraterrestrial event or contact.
Yeah. No, I find, and then again, you know, you find this fellow who had a great imagination, by the way. I mean, you know, he was a visionary in some ways, for sure, but a pragmatist more than anything. If you're going to say, you know, who is Ronald Reagan, I think I'd probably start by saying a very practical guy, a very pragmatic guy. You know, 2 + 2 = 4. Let's put the bricks, you know, one on top of the other. So for guys like that to, you know, have UFO experiences, I mean, how can you not take it seriously?
Oh, yeah. You know, these people in very, very serious, well, the most serious job in the world, especially the time that he was there through the Cold War and right up to the end of it, you know, there's a lot going on in that head. And to have that belief system in there too, and that understanding, while making decisions or looking at ways of, you know, in more of a peaceful aptitude, especially for Republicans, you know, he was he was more of the middle of the road. Let's try to get everybody working together on something.
Yes. Yeah. And you know, his relations with Tip O'Neill, the leading Democrat in the Senate, you know, shows that. I mean, they really got things accomplished, and I think that's a level of pragmatism that's demonstrable.
Now, let's as we kind of click away here, we've got let's talk a little bit more about the Mojave incident and how you got involved in that. Now, in the book itself, you have Elise and Tom Gifford, which you say, like, they're at Steve and Don Hess. And
that's correct.
The Mojave incident covers their an experience they had while on a desert camping trip, which mm-hmm. turned into just an absolute nightmare for them. Can you give it? Let's start off with, how did you actually get involved with that book, and where did you get that information from?
Yeah, well, you know, I guess I could start out by saying I'm a pragmatist as well. I was CEO of an industrial chemical company for 18 years. So it doesn't get more more hands-on and more pragmatic than that. We, you know, we help make cars, Teslas and Fords and BMWs, et cetera. So that's pretty pragmatic. So I was running this company, and we had a salesman on the West Coast named Paul Moran, who I'd hired. And yeah, we just became friends. He was a former football player and just a great guy. And so when I went out to the West Coast on business, we would usually have dinner afterwards. And, you know, just talk about family, business, etc. So he knew I was a writer, and I'd written several books before. And he knew pretty much I was looking for stories, always interested in, you know, what somebody thought about something or an anecdote. So he told me very confidentially about this couple. And he had played football with this fellow, Steve Hess, who was an all-state football player and for the University of Redlands, and they were best friends. And he said, you know, confidentially, this guy's life is a wreck, and so is the life of his wife. They're just nervous wrecks. He has no interest in working anymore, and this is a ladder climber kind of guy, you know, a socially mobile fellow with two kids at the time, two young children, a mortgage, etc., and a stay-at-home wife who took care of the kids, who were 4 and 2 at the time. And they had this alien abduction experience. He would kill me if he knew that I'm telling you this. But I think it would be really good for you two to meet. From his standpoint, Steve Hess and Dawn Hess, maybe you could introduce them to, you know, be more open about this, and maybe talk to a doctor, a psychologist, or a medical doctor, or a psychiatrist to you know, get this out of them, because it seems to be eating them alive. And from your standpoint, it's the best UFO alien abduction story, the most dramatic, the most concrete that I've ever encountered. So reluctantly, I agreed to meet with them, and I was just bowled over, first of all, with the story, which it took me about 4 visits to get out of them, but mostly with their credibility. Yeah.
Wow. But it is amazing, and I kind of fall back on our last conversation about them, and I still it resonates to me, because it's one of those things that I look back at and think, every so often when I hear someone talking about UFO abductions, their abduction story is really one of the most complicated, and I mean that by not only from the abduction itself, but what happens to their lives, the post-traumatic stress syndrome, and their let's call it a debriefing, and through hypnosis. It's absolutely amazing what they had gone through. And we're going to come back with more. We're going to touch more on that with Ron Felber. He is the author of The Mojave Incident and Dark Angel. And we're going to talk more about those two books right after this.
Hi there, this is Dave Scott, and I would like to invite you to listen Monday through Friday right here on Spaced Out Radio. 3 hours a night of the top stories with the top guests, ranging topics from UFOs to ETs, ghosts to Sasquatch, and everything in between. We are live every night, 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern. So come on in and take a listen at spacedoutradio.com. Spaced Out Radio will take you out of this world.
Would you like to become one of our space travelers? All you have to do is click on the space travelers icon at spacedoutradio.com. For only $5 a month, you can get access to some great prizes, as well as private monthly shows, newsletters, and a members-only section on our website. Become a space traveler today.
You hear footsteps in the empty room above you. A rocking chair begins rocking by itself. Don't be afraid of the things that go bump in the night. Reach for Spirit Story Box, the iPhone app the Huffington Post UK called the only ghost hunting app you will ever need. Spirit Story Box. The spirits are telling their stories. Are you listening?
Hi there, this is Elizabeth Anglin, and on the last Monday of every month, I join Dave Scott for Spaced Out Radio's Cosmic Passport. We delve into everything from extraterrestrial contact to animal communication. It's a lot of fun, and every month it's something different and exciting. I would love it if you would join us. You can hear and learn from my experiences, and I'd like to know about yours as well. Cosmic Passport on spacedoutradio.com.
Fairies? Bigfoot? Dogmen? Trolls? Goblins? Hey, if it's cryptid in any way, I'm looking into it. Hi there, this is author Ronald Murphy, also known as Spaced Out Radio's Crypto Guru. Join me every second Wednesday of the month on Spaced Out Radio with Dave Scott, where we will talk about the stories people call tall tales. I will fill you in on the latest sightings and the hidden histories that are causing quite a stir. You can find everything at spacedoutradio.com.
Hi there. This is your medium, Joanna, from Spaced Out Weekend, Two Mediums and a Large. I would love it if you would come and join us with host James Tyson every other Sunday on Spaced Out Weekend. Together, we will take your calls and your questions live. Our goal is to provide you with a positive outlook on deep questions that you may have. Questions regarding love, relationships, money, or whatever else is on your mind. Come and check us out at spacedoutradio.com.
Is the 24-hour world starting to wear you down? Let me, from Rivulet Reiki and Readings, lend you a hand. Hi, this is Jolene. And if you're in need of Reiki or a realm reading, come to my website, rivuletrnr.wix.com/rivuletrnr, and let us help you out. At Rivulet, I specialize in healing your body, mind, and soul, no matter where you are. And be sure to check out the Rivulet R&R Facebook page for your best deals. Remember, it's time for you to make some time for you.
Find yourself constantly looking up in the sky, looking for answers? Have you had extraterrestrial contact? Are you an abductee? Looking for answers to your experiences? Hi there, I'm R. Keith Andrews, Spaced Out Radio's resident ET expert. Join me live the first Friday of every month, where I take questions from the Spaced Out Radio chat room and help you understand those from the far-off world. It's 2 hours of knowledge every experiencer should listen to. Hope to see you there.
Spaced Out Weekend with James Tyson can be found at spacedoutradio.com. Head to our website, where you can join the Space Travelers and sign up for your new membership. You can also follow James on Twitter at JamesTysonSOR. Now, back to our paranormal guru, James Tyson.
We are with author and very cool guy, author of the Mojave Incident and his newest book, A Dark Angel, with Ron Felber. You can go to his website, ronfelber.com. That's R-O-N-F-E-L-B-E-R, ronfelber.com, and see what he has his fingers into. Ron, before the break, we were talking about the Mojave Incident and how you became involved in that, that story, which led you onto the book. Amazing, absolutely amazing. Did you get, and obviously you got a chance to interview the couple?
Yeah, actually, no, I have tapes. I would imagine 30 hours of tapes. And we actually videotaped the retrogressive sessions. And as I mentioned to you, and as you mentioned, I think the segment on Paranormal Witness will have segments of the tapes interspliced, and also interviews directly with the Hesses and myself and others and the doctors involved. So it should be fascinating. But what I found so unique and convincing is the incredible detail, the fact that there were two individuals, not just one, and that about 4 hours of it was conscious. So these people are in the back of a camper literally pinching themselves, saying, "Do you see this? Yes. Describe it to me." Just to make sure they're not crazy, just to make sure that they haven't gone insane. And at points in time, Dawn Hess says she thought they were in hell. They were in hell and being tortured. And so this kind of a conscious experience where you can describe what the aliens look like, what the craft looks like, what you're going through moment to moment, is I don't know the likes of it. And then another 4 hours when they're actually on the craft is recovered through hypnosis with Dr. William Annixter, from Asheville, North Carolina, who called the case the most convincing and compelling case of its kind that I've ever encountered. So, and these are two respected medical practitioners. Dr. Bernard Vitone from the National Center of Psychiatry is director of the National Center of Psychiatry in Washington, D.C., called it highly unusual, traumatizing events outside the realm of normal human experience.
Amazing. And the Mojave incident kind of gives it away on where this happened. But can you give my listener an idea? Just take back to the point where what were they doing out there, and then what happened?
Well, you know, if you have kids, particularly little kids, or a puppy like I do right now, you know that at times they can just sort of drive you crazy. So she wanted to be with adults. She had a 2-year-old and a 4-year-old, and she just wanted to be, you know, out of the house. So she wanted to go to see music, maybe see a band, do some dancing, and that was what her idea of a night out or weekend out was. And Steve, the husband, saw it a little differently. He was a hunter and had missed a shot at a mule deer a season before. His father and brother gave him a relentless hard time, so he was dead set with going back into the desert and hunting down that mule deer. So they had two divergent wishes. Unusual for them, they had Steve's parents come to La Mirada, California, where they lived, from Barstow, all the way from Barstow, so they could babysit for the weekend. So this was a big deal for them. What they did was compromise. The idea was that that on Friday night they'd go to Whiskey Pete's, which is a place where they could do some gambling and also listen to some music and dance and have a couple of drinks. And then the next day they would go to Mid Hills campsite where they would sleep, and then go into the desert, and he would do his hunting the following day. What happened was, and again, you have to look at these as all huge coincidences, even the point of me finding this couple. But Mid Hills, which should never have been full that night, was totally booked. And what they decided to do was go right into the desert. And this is a landscape that was formed 150 million years ago. It's filled with rare earths. That Alumax, for example, mines, lanthanum, ceruleum, a lot of rare metals, et cetera, that are used in high-tech weaponry. Also, there's Tabletop Mountain, which is an unusual mountain that has literally a flat top. Sema Dome, which is the most perfect natural sphere in the world, and it's huge. So it's a very unique and unusual landscape.
Yeah, and I was drifting away. I was listening to, and I leaned back in my chair, and I was like, "Ah, yes." And you painted a very good picture of this place. So they go off into the desert, and they're in a little truck with a camper, I guess, on it.
Mm-hmm. Or
a
cabin. Exactly. That's exactly correct.
Yeah, and an attempt to sleep.
Well, this is what happens. Actually, so they cook up a couple steaks, and frankly, Dawn Hess is nervous. They're in the middle of nowhere, and now it's dark. And, there were rumors in the newspaper of drug deals that happen in the desert, motorcycle gangs that do nefarious things in the desert. And so she was really nervous about them being kidnapped or her being raped or something along those lines. And so she didn't really like, she was really a little annoyed, more than a little annoyed, at Steve for not being able to get a place at Mid Hills, for not reserving it or whatever. So he realized that. And they had their steaks. They had a glass of wine and were roasting marshmallows. When all of a sudden, the noise in the desert, and at night the desert's very noisy, stopped. There wasn't a sound. Then they see 9 objects about 200, 300 yards away, set like diamonds in the sky, shining so bright they created daylight around them. So these 9 objects then go behind Tabletop Mountain and form a configuration like an M. They start blinking like in some kind of communication. And I mean, they're like stunned. So Steve doesn't want to make his wife any more nervous than she already is. Talks about, well, maybe it's a military exercise. You know, it's the desert. Maybe it's experimental craft. Maybe. But then these objects, hundreds of them now, start dropping from the sky and racing towards them. And the crafts, or inside the crafts apparently, are beings. And the beings have red eyes that glow in the dark. And so what they see are hundreds of gremlin-type creatures rushing at them with red eyes that that shine in the dark. Steve runs to the camper. He gets out a 12-gauge Ithaca shotgun and a 7-millimeter Browning rifle with a hunting vest, you know, looped with rounds of ammunition, and he's ready to shoot. He doesn't. He thinks it's a Russian invasion at this point, and so does Dawn. So suddenly she grabs him by the arm and says, "Don't you hear what they're telling you? Don't try to hurt them or they'll kill you. They want us to get in the back of the camper." So reluctantly, he turns and puts his gun down, but then he hears the same voice, this telepathic voice. And really, much out of character, almost like they're hypnotized, they walk to the back, go in the camper with the tail down, sit Indian style, him with a shotgun across his legs, and wait. And what happens is these gremlin-type creatures just surround them, and they're almost like diabolically, clearly malevolent and frenetic, just frenzied with energy. Then two sort of electrical fields, like fire hydrants, glowing, stay at the lip of the tailgate. And every time he moves forward, they move forward. And when he tries to get out, he's thrown back by a violent electrical shock. So now they're trapped in the camper. They look up, and now they see a huge beam of light, perhaps 200 feet in diameter on the ground, shooting down to the ground, picking things up, and sending things down. And when they look up, above them they see a UFO that Steve describes as the size of a football field that literally caps the valley. And the next thing they know, 9 different kinds of creatures, these illuminated and with spindly appendages, raven dark eyes, black eyes that don't have pupils, like cones almost that go into their head, surround the camper. And that's when, you know, the mind tear, the experiments and the torture begins.
Oh my God. That, I just got chills. The, you know, just even to see one thing with red eyes running toward you at night in a desert would be enough to give me the heebie-jeebies and probably start the camper and drive away, as opposed to, you know, 100 of them coming at you and then being forced in the back. It's and it's amazing he did follow the instructions of, you know, don't shoot or you'll die.
I think he had no choice in the end.
Yeah.
You know, I think this voice was compelling, and I think in the end they sort of drifted there and probably don't remember really taking the 20 steps to the camper, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, it's, you know, that part of your brain kind of just shuts down. It's, you know, okay, I'm going to the camper, and thanks for not killing me, you little weasels. So they're trapped in the camper, and, yeah. You know, just can you describe this? Do they go into the detail in the Mojave incident? You do cover a bit of the events inside the camper. What did Dawn describe as the torture that she felt?
Well, basically, you know, I want to put this as delicately as I can, but she was molested as a child, and so she had a deep set you know, bad memories of this childhood molestation. And so these beings, without saying anything, just hovered, and their eyes are just piercing. They pull the blinds, and of course the light is so bright it goes through the blinds anyway. And she was made to relive some of the really horrible experiences in her life, and one of them was that, being molested by an older man, you know, an adult, when she was, 6 or 7 years old. So this was horrifying to her. Steve, in the meantime, was put through another battery of sort of visions that was almost like they were really there, of him being hunted, like he was going to hunt the mule deer, and then actually being shot, running, and being skinned. There are other emotions that they feel, avarice, exaltation when he was a football player, good experiences like their marriage, the day they were married. But also in the camper, something very strange happened. And Steve, while she's in this horrible state, which you can imagine, gets sexually aggressive with her in the camper. And of course, this creates an eruption like you couldn't believe. But this is, totally unlike him. But Dawn says later, and so does Steve, that all of this seems to have been a methodology for studying human emotions, putting them through the most horrifying things, the most prideful or pleasurable things, fear, anger, hatred, joy, exaltation, and because they wanted to understand how human emotions work, because they didn't have any emotions.
Oh. So and that's how they came out of it, like looking back at it, they thought, okay, this is,
well, under hypnosis, that's what came
under
out.
Hypnosis.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing.
And actually, you had mentioned about you would get the heebie-jeebies. Well, they thought they were gonna die many times, but their hearts were pounding, and they thought they were gonna have heart attacks, both of them. So they're holding each other, and when that happened and they felt like they were either going to go crazy or have a heart attack and die, a mist came into the camper that calmed them and, de-escalated their heartbeat and almost like a sedation, an anesthesia. And if you think about it in a way, it's like these beings were keeping them alive so they could do all of their experiments.
Oh, I see. Yeah. You know, taking them to the edge of death and then bringing them back just to see, you know, those little beggars.
Yeah. Well, these were the illuminated figures. And you know, they're described, you know, very vividly in the book. And really, you know, these were like scientists. These were clinical, you know, beings. They were there to study, clearly.
They weren't getting
psychology.
They weren't getting like a real rush of excitement themselves on the negativity that they were.
No, not at all. However, the smaller beings that they described as kind of gremlins, like diabolical gremlins, would get more excited as they got more frightened. They'd get more agitated.
Okay. In a positive way or a...
No. They seemed to enjoy the fact. They got off on the fact that these people were scared to death.
Oh, yeah. So it was sort of positive for the little gremlin ones that, okay, this is a good thing. If we scare these people
yeah,
to the
I guess.
Point of dying, then this is fun.
Yeah, in a perverse way, I suppose, yes.
Yeah, I wonder if it's they could feed off that energy then.
That was the impression that Steve got.
Yeah, that is just creepy. And were there any other types of beings that they encountered? You've got the doctor ones, you've got the gremlin ones. What else did they...
Well, you know, this is one of the more fascinating aspects of the story. And this is all while they're conscious. So like I said, they're pinching one another. They're, you know, comparing notes. While they're doing this, a lot of things are going on. And I compare it to pulling a curtain and seeing another universe, seeing a whole other existence. a realm of existence, because what they see then is a what they call the searcher. It's a triangular shaped vehicle, not large, combing the desert basin like a mining operation, and they could feel this drilling in the ground that vibrated and smell this sulfurous, phosphorus kind of odor that was very heavy and rank. So this mining operation was going on while all the rest was happening to them. And when they finally came to the brink of madness, where again Dawn said we thought we were in hell and had died, and that you know, our immortal souls would be tortured like this forever. That's what they thought. They were praying. They were worried about their children. They were just, you know, it was an awful experience. So when they thought they couldn't take it anymore, were about to go insane, a different presence, an angelic presence, similar to something you read about in the Bible or hear about in a Marian visitation at Lourdes or Fatima, but a kind of swirling white cloud comes down, takes the shape of a woman, clearly feminine, and they hear the voice, "Don't worry, this will all be over soon," and everything starts to calm down. The gremlins start to recede, the nine illuminated figures leave as they had come, and they get very drowsy, and they wind up sort of collapsing in the back of the camper. And this is where the missing time comes. It comes in.
Okay. And this would be the possible movement from their camper to a ship at this point?
Yes. Yes. The ship that was hovering over them.
Well, do they actually remember the movement?
No. What happened was they woke up and it was morning. So a lot of time had gone by. The campfire is dead, so this was a blazing fire they're cooking marshmallows on, right, and steak. So their fire is completely dead. They're laying on the ground. The camper door is open. And, you know, they wake up and they think the world has ended. They think, you know, that some catastrophic thing has happened and they were in the desert and sort of escaped it somehow. But later, as they get home, they start to have vivid nightmares, insomnia, sexual dysfunction, just this weight of depression. Steve had no interest in working anymore. He just thought everything was so minor compared to what he'd seen.
Mm-hmm.
That you know, work seemed trivial, mundane. And so he was just in this terrible malaise. And really, that's when Paul Moran contacted me.
Well, you're describing all the symptoms of post-traumatic stress.
As a matter of fact, that's exactly what Dr. Vitone came out with. He said they have no psychosis, they have no neurosis, they're not prone to fantasies. You know, they're pragmatists. This guy's in the construction business. So at the end, I'm compelled to believe that they are suffering from post-traumatic stress from the experience, and that what they say happened to them really happened.
Yeah, you get post-traumatic stress from an experience, and so you need the experience to get it. So
yeah,
therefore,
exactly.
It must have happened. Now, this is the part, Ron, that they start disclosing their activity on the ship through hypnosis?
Yeah, what happened was, you know, I was not qualified, or I didn't even know where to begin with this story. Because once they started talking about nightmares and told of an experience where they were asleep and they felt the aliens were surrounding them, they were awakened and they see these alien beings surrounding them, or a time when Steve wakes up in the middle of the night and sees one of the aliens touching with a three-fingered hand his wife's face and just stroking her face. And he says he's heard a voice that says this is a dream, and he realizes it's not a dream. And Dawn wakes up, and she has three streaks across her face, burn marks. She goes to the mirror and, of course, freaks out. He takes Polaroids of them immediately, And that, yeah, that's one experience. Another is where their older child, who was about four, Steve Jr., is screaming in the middle of the night. So they rush into the room and they find him spinning like a top. Spinning like a top. So Dawn runs to him and grabs him, hugs him, and calms him down. And it was like he was in a trance and just emerged from this trance. So she tells him, don't worry. And he says, no, they're monsters. The monsters have come. She says, oh, there are no monsters. You know, just go to sleep. He says, yes, there are monsters. Don't turn out the light, because when you do, the monsters come. No monsters. Don't worry. They are. They have red eyes. And that, you know, then she realized this was just really getting into their lives in a way that was incredibly deep.
Did they reach out to the psychologist at the university, or how did that those two groups come together?
Well, I'd gone to Georgetown University. That's where I graduated undergraduate. And my roommate for a time wound up going to the medical school there. So, you know, from undergraduate right into medical school. So his name was Kevin Gleason. And, you know, writers can't be shy. So I called him up, even though I hadn't seen him in years, and said, hey, look, I need a favor. This is the story, and I want a really qualified person who's credible and everyone will, agree is credible to examine them for psychosis, for, you know, to see if they're prone to fantasy, to see if they're crazy, to see if this is believable. And so he recommended Dr. Vitone, who was director of the National Center of Psychiatry. And then Dr. Vitone recommended William Annixter from North Carolina to do the hypnosis, but both were more than intrigued.
Oh, that would be absolutely fascinating to get that file on your desk. We're talking to Ron Felber. Go to see his website, ronfelber.com. See the books he's written. We're talking about his book, The Mojave Incident. We're going to be talking about that and then getting into Dark Angel in the second half. We're going to be back with more from Ron right after this.
Become more intimate and interactive with Spaced Out Radio. Join our Space Travelers Club with your new membership. For $5 a month, we'll provide you with special access to the website, monthly prize draws from books to psychic readings, along with monthly newsletter, private interviews, and more. Sign up today to be part of Spaced Out Radio's experience.
Are you an ET experiencer, but you just don't know what's going on? Are you too timid or shy to discuss it with anyone? Maybe I can help. Join me, R. Keith Andrews, the first Friday of every month on Spaced Out Radio, and I will help you to find the answers you're looking for. Together, I will help you understand the off-worlders and the true meanings behind your experiences. All you have to do is join us in the Spaced Out Radio chat room. See you there.
Hey everybody, this is Patrick Webster Small, and I'm here to bring you the Webster Phenomena every Saturday night, live at 8 p.m. Pacific, 11 p.m. Eastern. If you're looking for aliens and extraterrestrials, well, we've got them. Big and tall, short and small, you're bound to find what you're looking for. So join me on the Webster Phenomena right here on Spaced Out Radio.
Hi there, this is Jolene with Rivulet Reiki and Readings, and I want you to relax. Let me help you chill out and get in touch with your body, mind, and soul. In this busy world, sometimes we need to let go, and this is where I can help. Visit my website, rivuletr&r.wix.com/rivuletr&r, or my Facebook page, Rivulet R&R, to set up an appointment for relaxation, Reiki, or readings, no matter where you are. It's time for you to make time for you.
Visit purpleplates.com today. For over 40 years, the Purple Energy Plates have been delivering amazing results for their many customers. Inspired by the great genius Nikola Tesla, the harmony, healing, and energetic effects of the plates have proven over and over to be beneficial and often miraculous to thousands of customers. With their money-back guarantee and the many benefits, how can you afford not to get one? Check their site for daily specials and choose from their many energy products. You won't be sorry. Visit them today at purpleplates.com for mind, body, and spirit. And expect a miracle.
Have you ever seen a UFO, a ghost, Bigfoot, or something else weird or arcane? This is Dave Scott, host of Spaced Out Radio. Every night, starting at 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern Time, we are live for 3 hours of jam-packed information with the top guests from their field of expertise. Come take a listen and share your experiences with us. You can find everything you need at spacedoutradio.com. Are you experienced?
Have you ever wondered about those weird and strange creatures people have reported throughout history? Do you wonder if those stories are real? Me too, and that's why I started Cryptopia.us. Hey, this is Rob Morphy, crypto historian. Join me once a month on Spaced Out Radio with Dave Scott, where we will get into the odd and bizarre reports, from the Dover Demon to hairy hominids and everything in between. I will break down what people like you and me are seeing at spacedoutradio.com.
Looking for a place to get your product to the public? Advertise with us at Spaced Out Radio. At spacedoutradio.com, you can check out our pricing and packages that best suit your budgetary needs. Whether you're a budgeted author or a company looking to expand, our listeners support the products that support spacedoutradio.com. Advertising with us is an effective way to get your message out. Contact us at info@spacedoutradio.com and get your ads out today.
James Tyson can be found on Facebook at Spaced Out Weekend. You can follow James on Instagram, Spaced Out Weekend, on YouTube, Spaced Out Radio Show, and on Twitter, at James Tyson, S-O-R. And don't forget to sign up to become a space traveler on our website, spacedoutradio.com.
Welcome back, everybody. We are with Ron Felber. He is an author and actually becoming a rather famous man, as his works are being picked up by anything from Netflix to Paranormal Witness in October, where they're going to take his book, The Mojave Incident, which we're talking about right now, and turn it into a one-hour special. And like Ron was saying, there, some of the video that was taken, he took of what we're talking about right now, their hypnotic regression sessions should be on Paranormal Witness. Again, look for that coming up in October. Ron, we've got the Steve and Don now made connections to the hospital, and of course the people who want to look into this activity and study them are a little bit giddy, and because this is not something you'd anticipate coming across your desk every day. What happens from there? Were they open to going to the to have the hypnosis done?
Yes, I think they really wanted to know more about their experience from an objective professional standpoint. So really, what Paul Moran, who introduced them to me, predicted really happened, in that I was able to get them in touch and go with them to be examined, to be evaluated, to be assessed psychologically, physically, and that's what happened. But I also want to mention, too, that both William Annixter and Dr. Vitcone, both medical doctors and very prominent, that both these are brown shoe kind of guys. Do you know what I mean? They're like, I wear a jacket and tie every morning, and that's who I am. These are very conservative fellows with reputations to protect. So they were intrigued, but I think they went into this saying, let me debunk this.
Yeah. Which is
find out what really happened.
Yeah, and that really should be the proper way to go in. Like, we'll find all the reasons why it couldn't have happened, and then if that doesn't work, then we come up with a different solution or a conclusion. But you kind of go in with that. Okay, what are you saying, and what else could it have been?
Sure, some of the obvious ones were drugs, but they don't take drugs. And if they were taking some sort of hallucinogens, I don't know, LSD or peyote or mescaline or whatever, they wouldn't have, it's impossible for them to have the same hallucinations. The hallucinations derive from deep in their brain, and it's very individualistic. You and I would never have the same hallucinations because our experiences are different. So that's one thing that discounted drugs. This was not the result of drugs. Plus, they're the last people in the world that would take drugs. Second would be that they had a giant misunderstanding, that there was some kind of a desert warfare exercise going on, and they encountered it. But a little like Fife Symington, the governor of Arizona, Steve Hess and Dawn Hess said, well, what we saw was something like 200 yards. This was a floating city, like a fortress. Unless somebody figured out how to make Seattle, you know, float in the air and take off at incredible speeds, it wasn't a desert warfare exercise. So that was discounted. They took a polygraph test, and Dawn didn't because she was pregnant. By the time I actually talked to them this was all worked out. But Steve did, and passed with flying colors. So the other thing, let me try to think, botulism, that maybe they ate some rancid food. But all of these were discounted by both Annixter and Vuitton.
Yeah.
And the other is that they were crazy. You know, that they were just either prone to fantasy, psychotic, neurotic, but the testing came back that they were very, very normal.
Yeah, and it comes down to, two, we have different metabolisms, so how can two people share the same vision, whether they've got botulism, they're on drugs, or they're crazy? You can't.
Yeah, exactly.
You can't both look at the same thing and see it as the same thing, if you know what I mean.
That's what makes this so compelling, again, is that people in detail describing to one another, just to double check, you know, that they weren't crazy. So, yeah, it really becomes a very compelling case.
What happens in the hypnotherapy or the hypnotic regression?
Well, I mean, some stunning revelations, I would say. They both have memories of being not brought onto the craft, but being like kind of a people mover in an airport on something along those lines, that below them it was sort of transparent, very brilliantly lit. Steve remembers, and during hypnosis actually started, I mean, screaming, that they took Dawn away. And literally you could see him fighting. He doesn't, you know, I fought. I wanted, you know, what did not want them to take her away. And so he got very emotional during that time. And both he and Dawn were separated and examined separately. We found out later during the hypnosis session, kept pawing at her neck. And so Dr. Anderson said, why are you doing that? And she would say, I don't know. Then after, you know, getting at the question three different ways, she finally screamed, probes. They put probes in me. And that's how they track us. That's how they watch us. That's how they know where we are and what we're doing, which is a stunning sort of comment. And so that's one of the things that happened. Also, you know, Steve really actually started crying. And again, this is a very masculine guy talking about anal probes and needles being put in him. And finally, he just almost broke down and said, I want to go home, because he was reliving it. I want to go home. Mm-hmm. I want to see my kids.
Yeah, that's crazy. That is amazing. And, of course, they're both talking about us, you know, under separate hypnotherapy, that they're talking about the same incident and describing the same things. It is absolutely frightening, and I can see why a paranormal witness wants to kind of drill down into this. Again, that's coming up in October. Now, how are these people doing now? You know, they've come kind of out of their paranormal closet to a point and have been interviewed. And, you know, they're kind of more they're more comfortable with what happened, or?
I think so, because years have gone by. But I did wanted to make one last point, if it's okay, about the hypnotic sessions.
Yeah.
And what happened with Dawn. There was a period, very suddenly, where she sat up in her chair rigid. Her voice was different, like very staccato. And the doctor said, what's happening? And she said, you know, she wouldn't answer. Finally, He asked, do you want to talk about what happened to you, more about what happened to you on the spacecraft? You know, no, I don't remember. I don't want to talk about it. But then he started asking specific questions. If these beings are here, do you know why they're here? And all of a sudden, again, in a sort of a language pattern, totally unlike her, she says there are five galaxies. These creatures are sent by the One Supreme. Their mission is to desensitize people for a broad-based communication to unite the five galaxies. So Dr. Annixter then says something like, what else do you know? And she says, I know where the universe ends. So he says, is that something you can put in words? She says, and again, without thinking about it, our universe ends where theirs begins. Our universe ends when its matter starts mattering to them and stops mattering to us.
Oh, that's a little, yeah, that is one of those statements that, you know, is a riddle almost.
Yeah.
Yeah, and
So Annixter then said, when will this contact happen? She says, I don't know. Then he asked again. And finally she said, he says, will it happen in my lifetime? And she says, how long are you going to live? And then he says, well, give me a time frame. He said, in your children's lifetime.
Okay. So we have some idea, obviously, through Don, they were communicating with him.
Absolutely.
Did you happen to catch that on video?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, that should be. Actually, I had a video tape. There were copies made. I had a copy, but the doctors have, you know, their copies.
Yeah.
And I'm sure they're chronicled. So in the book, almost the entire scene and the words that she used are, you know, almost verbatim.
Ron, have you been contacted by any government group that says, you know, we really don't want you talking about this?
No, nothing like that.
So we're not going to worry about the conspiracy and the men in black and all that stuff.
I hope not. But I do live in a very sequestered area. So.
Okay.
So they're going to have to find me first.
We'll post your address on.
We'll find you
by Google Earth. Yeah. There he is. That is, you know, I've heard that from some people where they come out talking about their abduction issues and they say they were visited by these black guys wearing black suits, and then they forgot. The guys in black suits would mumble to them, and then they would forget bits and pieces of their experience. But in this case, it sounds like it's a whole different group of beings that have come down, and a very interesting communication with through Don to the doctor.
Actually, even if somebody did jumble my memories of this, this is chronicled.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah, this is chronicled. And you want to hear just a really odd little story about maybe fate and destiny. But there's a woman that does a talk show with about a million listeners named Betsy Lewis, mm-hmm. out of Minnesota. So I was doing, of course, my Jack Madsen books and promoting those and doing a lot of radio. So she calls me and says, I'd like to do an hour interview with you. So, of course, I think it's about the Jack Madsen series. So I said, fine. I mean, which book would you like to talk about? Or maybe you'd like to talk about, you know, all three. All two at the time. She goes, I want to talk about your UFO book. I said, well, that UFO book is out of print and hasn't been, you know, available for years. She said, well, I had a copy that I picked up in a garage sale. I put it on my bookshelf where I work in my office, and I was writing something, and it fell off the shelf. I read it in a sitting, and that's how I came to know about this book. I interviewed with her the next day on eBay. Old copies of the book were selling for $500 a copy. Reviews were all over the place, and that's how it got reprinted. Isn't that something?
And how many did you sell on eBay?
I wouldn't get anything for that.
Yeah,
these
I know.
Are, you know, these,
I know,
yeah.
But if you could go to the garage, pull out an old box full, and go, hey, I can get these on eBay for $500.
yeah.
But that's amazing. And it's, you talk about karma, you talk about you know, somebody almost getting hit over the head would say, hey, look at this, get the message out there.
Absolutely. Yeah, literally almost hit over the head, huh?
Yeah. Now, your success with that has obviously continues, again, with the paranormal witness picking it up for an hour episode. You've written your new book, Dark Angel, which is fiction, but how do they kind of join? You have a bit of a, what's the overlap in those from your fiction to the nonfiction?
Well, you know, much of Dark Angel is based on fact. So I would say it's a fact-based thriller, something along those lines, and speculative also. I mean, the premise basically is that Nazi scientist Joseph Mengele, while he's escaping Germany, the Allies are invading, carries a chrome case that's containing genetic material to create transhuman slaughter machines. And basically these were super soldiers. So Hitler, towards the end of the war, devoted all of his energy to a atom bomb or some super weapon, and slaughter machines were one of them. These would be beings that were part human and, drugged, used, under behavioral modification programs, drugged, etc. But they would kill nonstop for days with no need for food, water, or sleep until they self-terminated. So Mengele's plane crashes in the Swiss Alps, and the CIA recovers the case. So faced with the growing military threat from China, you know, i.e. that U.S. troops would be hopelessly outnumbered in a ground war, the Department of Defense develops their own iteration of Mengele's slaughter machines in underground labs at Princeton University. Later, a serial killer emerges on campus, the likes of which the world has never seen. So the idea of transhumans and the Nazis influencing our intelligence agencies is absolutely fact-based. These are the kind of things they're working on right now.
Oh, that's just overly creepy. And I've heard about super soldiers. I read a story of a young woman who got herself into the U.S. military. And I guess she was a very sensitive person, we'll call an uber psychic, but she didn't quite understand it. She just thought she was really weird. And she said they have people that would walk through when they're joining, and they kind of walk through the lines of the people, kids coming into the military, and picking them out, because those people, whether they're very highly sensitive humans or let's call them non-human, they can identify those people. And then they're partway through basic training, they're isolated and pulled out, saying, would you like to go? We think you'd do really well in this branch of the government. And it's a kind of a beyond black ops thing. And that's where those kind of people are either experimented on, or their skill set is probed and tuned.
Oh, that's very believable. As a matter of fact, in the research for Dark Angel, I came upon a document that I think was stunning. It was given to me by a former congressman who was on the Defense Committee and was investigating Operation Phoenix, a program that went on in the later stages of Vietnam. This is maybe I'll quote a little bit from one of the participants. He says, as standard equipment, most of us carried hush puppies, a Mark 22 Model O, which used 9mm ammo and had a 5-inch barrel equipped with silencer. The weapon, along with the fact that each of us could kill with our hands, had only one other thing in common. We were insane. The most important element of the program, aside from the men, was the drug supplied by the local case manager that kept us awake for days at a time, erased the deeds committed from the mind, and allowed peace to enter the soul, at least for a period. It was called the Green Hornet, a capsule containing a mixture of benzedrine and amphetamine, which stimulates the central nervous system, Dexamil, a synthetic steroid that stimulated the adrenal glands and made a man superhuman, and reserpine, commonly used to treat high blood pressure in mental patients. So he goes on to say, the Green Hornet that he described was a capsule that caused a man to, quote, act faster than normal. He could feel his heart speed up. The head would throb, and it felt as if the brain was actually growing. It gave the man his own personal radar, and his senses were fine-tuned to an extreme pitch. Every nerve ending was sensitive to sound, sight, and smell, and it seemed as if a receiver was in the brain. Put all this together, and a man could stay awake for days, fight, function, kill, and not lose his mind. Isn't that incredible?
That is crazy. You go back into the Second World War, even when amphetamines were given to pilots and bomber crew who were up for hours and hours and hours, and it kept them awake and highly sensitive. And I know from my experience as a peace officer dealing with people addicted to methamphetamine, it turns their fine motor skills into an incredible focused, along with focus and their fine motor skills. They are the ones that do our credit card fraud. They can go through a shredder in a business and put all those shredded pieces of paper together, and they'll sit for hours focused on doing it. It's such a we would go crazy doing it in the first.
It's called hyper focus.
Yeah, and it's the amphetamine that does it. And
For all our previous, years in military, going back to World War II or Vietnam, wherever, Gulf War, our technologies have been aimed outward, basically to control our environment, tanks, guns, etc. Now they're being aimed inward to merge what they call GRIN technologies. GRIN stands for genetics, robotics, artificial intelligence, and nanotechnology. So with these in mind, they can actually alter your mind, your memory, your metabolism, your personality, even your children's personality. You've heard about designer children, for example.
Yeah.
You know, what sex, what color eyes, what intelligence levels, how much athleticism, etc. These are all things that through radically enhanced evolution, they call it, can be accomplished.
Yeah, and when you start using a drug like you say, the Green Hornet, how many drugs came before that, and how long ago was that document written, and what's happened since?
Exactly.
Like you say, the nanotechnology, and where do you stop? As a government, where do you stop dealing with mind altering drugs and technology? Do you stop on the military? Is this part of the community giving you a bad time? Maybe we can use it on them.
Yeah.
Who knows?
And by the way, physically, I mean, again, these men that are built now to have 10 times the strength that they normally would. For example, the University of Pennsylvania created, and this is known, this was actually written about in Lancet, the scientific journal in England, University created genetically modified mighty mouse, shockingly large and muscular, massive haunches, necks wider than their heads. So if you think about athletes now, I mean, with doping, I was watching a bodybuilding thing on television. And you look at these guys so far beyond where Arnold Schwarzenegger was, for example, and they've really altered their bodies through doping and through drugs, incredibly, so that they've become transhumans, something other than human.
Yeah.
In that their bodies are altered, and human beings are not meant to have, wrists, thighs, biceps like they have. But they do.
Yeah.
And clearly they're performance enhancing too,
Yeah. And, you even get into the years ago, the U.S. the Australian military, for their commandos, they prescribe anabolic steroids.
Isn't that something?
Yeah. This is what we'll do. You guys need to be big. You need to be angry. And you need to get in there and deal with things.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that would be a scary lot coming over a mountain. There's no reasoning with somebody, and I've seen them. I've had to deal with bouncers at nightclubs that are, under roid rage, almost killing people because they hit a switch and they just keep going.
Well, there's an organization underneath the Department of Defense called DARPA, And DARPA was formed by Eisenhower after the Second World War. And their job and function was to take the best minds and scientists in the world and stay one generation ahead of every military in the world. So the U.S. was always more technically advanced by a full generation than its closest adversary. So if you're talking about bouncers and anabolic steroids, imagine what somebody like DARPA, when they're commissioned to create metabolically enhanced soldiers, you know, that have no physical, psychological, or cognitive limitations, you know, soldiers that if they're wounded have a self-healing quality to their blood so that their blood doesn't bleed like yours or mine would, that can, again, stay awake for days, use their body fat for days, live off their body fat with no sense of hunger, no sense of pain. I mean, that's the kind of thing that not only exists in Dark Angel, it exists in reality.
Oh, yeah. I think a while ago, I was reading about using drugs like just street drugs, LSD and things like that, to enhance a psychological super soldier. The super soldier technology and inner armor and what was the one that like the 24/7 warrior, the guy who could just, like you say, mm-hmm. run on psychic vision, hallucinogenic warfare was the PCP and the LSD. Mm-hmm. Researchers doing that with U.S. Army volunteers from the mid-50s right up to the early 70s. But they found that those drugs were too mellow for weapons use.
Yeah.
But
you'd asked about the effects on society and civilization. I mean, I think we're riding a curve of exponential change that's unprecedented in human history. It's not only transforming our lives, it's transforming what it means to be human. For example, I think this is probably in a way happening already, but basically there'll be two kinds of people, at least, the naturals and the enhanced. The enhanced will be designed. They will, be bred, genetically engineered to be super intelligent, maybe super athletic, maybe a super soldier. And then there'll be the naturals. Probably the criterion will be who they are, how much money you have to pay for these kinds of things. But at the end, there'll be two kinds of living beings in the world. Let's start with Canada and the United States. One that's a small group that's enhanced and runs things, and the others that are kind of drones that are naturals. It's leading to a whole different view of what it means to be human and what it means to have a society. It's certainly not going to be a democratic one.
Okay. On that note, we're going to take our break and come back with our fourth quarter with more really enlightening and fluffy and candy kind of talk with Ron Felber. And I'll be putting a lot larger locks on the doors of my house. Right back with more from Ron right after this.
Hi there. This is your psychic medium, Joanna. And I would love it if you would join us every other Sunday on Spaced Out Weekend. With host James Tyson, we'll bring you personal psychic messages on two mediums and a large. Questions about love, life, career changes. We would love it if you would come and join us live. Call in and listen in for the experience. Allow us to open the doors to your other side. Two mediums and a large, heard only on Spaced Out Weekend at spacedoutradio.com.
Attention, Spaced Out Radio listeners. For only $5 a month, you can join Spaced Out Radio Space Travelers. Your membership at spacedoutradio.com will give you access to private fan area on the website, get you a monthly newsletter, draws for monthly swag, and a whole lot more. Sign up today to become a part of the Spaced Out Radio experience.
Hi there, this is Spaced Out Radio host Dave Scott. Join me Monday through Friday at 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern Time at spacedoutradio.com
where we delve into all things paranormal, supernatural, extraterrestrial, crypto, and all topics in between. Come on by, take a listen, and tell us about your experiences. We are here for the answers you need. Spaced Out Radio, broadcasting right out of this world.
Strange creatures lurking in the night, the sounds of wood knocking in the forest, odd happenings right out of a fictional world. These are the reports I love. Hi there, this is author Ronald Murphy, and I would love it if you join me and Spaced Out Radio host Dave Scott the second Wednesday of every month on our journey into the unknown land of cryptozoology at spacedoutradio.com. From Mothman to Frogman and everything in between. Hey, they don't call me the crypto guru for nothing.
Visit purpleplates.com today. For over 40 years, the Purple Energy Plates have been delivering amazing results for their many customers. Inspired by the great genius Nikola Tesla, the harmony, healing, and energetic effects of the plates have proven over and over to be beneficial and often miraculous to thousands of customers. With their money-back guarantee and the many benefits, how can you afford not to get one? Check their site for daily specials and choose from their many energy products. You won't be sorry. Visit them today at purpleplates.com for mind, body, and spirit. And expect a miracle. Visit purpleplates.com today. For over 40 years, the Purple Energy Plates have been delivering amazing results for their many customers. Inspired by the great genius Nikola Tesla, the harmony, healing, and energetic effects of the plates have proven over and over to be beneficial and often miraculous to thousands of customers. With their money-back guarantee and the many benefits, how can you afford not to get one? Check their site for daily specials and choose from their many energy products. You won't be sorry. Visit them today at purpleplates.com for mind, body, and spirit. And expect a miracle.
Every month on Spaced Out Radio, we look into the deep and dark reports of cryptids roaming around the world with me, Rob Morphy from Cryptopia.us. I would love it if you would join me and host Dave Scott as we delve into the most arcane stories and reports regarding creatures of the unknown. My job is to hunt down the details and bring the evidence forward to you. These aren't your regular Bigfoot stories I'm talking about either. You can find out more about crypto history at spacedoutradio.com.
With an ever-expanding listenership base, Spaced Out Radio is the perfect place for you to advertise your product. Our listeners support those who sponsor this show. So whether you're an author or a company, Spaced Out Radio is the perfect place for you. Our pricing is more than competitive, and your advertisements will be seen and heard every show. Head to spacedoutradio.com and advertise with us today. Contact us at info@spacedoutradio.com today.
Tonight's edition of Spaced Out Weekend is brought to you by spacedoutradio.com, where you can now sign up to become a Space Traveler member. Now, for the final time tonight, here's Spaced Out Weekend's James Tyson.
Welcome back to the fourth quarter, everybody, with here on Spaced Out Weekend. My guest is Ron Felber. He is an author of a number of books, including the Jack Madison novel
Madison.
It's my dyslexia. Yeah. Madison. He is the Jack Madison series, and his latest book, Dark Angel, which talks about Jack Madison dealing with these super soldiers. It's part of the trilogy. It's a trilogy. And Jack is coming up against Nazi geneticists building transhuman serial or transhumans, and then bumps into a serial killer. Interesting. And what myself and my listener finds interesting is the parallels that you've drawn between the fiction and the nonfiction, and the nonfiction being how military over the years has continued to try to develop these, well, we always call them super soldiers, but I think we almost use that term so loosely it doesn't mean anything anymore. Oh, it's a super soldier, or it's almost like X-Men. You know,
exactly.
It's exactly. A whole cartoon kind of thing, and it's all warm and fuzzy now.
Yeah, metabolically enhanced soldiers as a result of radical evolution. is probably a more accurate way to describe it.
Yeah. And the amount of effort, you know, we always look at the, we look back at the Olympics in the 70s and you had the U.S. swimmers versus the Russian swimmers or vice versa. And you look at those women standing up on the, getting their medals and those Russian women with those great big Neanderthal brows and their body was distorted by the use of steroids for many, many years.
Sure.
And you think, okay, if the U.S. is doing this, usually the Soviet Union was also doing it and usually threw in a lot more money and really didn't care what happened to the people after they experimented on them. So I wonder what their system looks like compared to a Western system where, you get volunteers from the military to come in and DARPA, continues its human experiments to create the military super soldier again. And, it's, you wonder what the Chinese version is and the Russian version is. The Canadian version, I think we're still working on people to advance maple syrup and bacon, but it's
I think that for example, Albert Einstein, and I use this quote in the book, famously said that giving technology to the military is like giving an axe to a serial killer. At the end, they're going to use what they can. Their job is to figure out how to defend the country, if that's the way you want to phrase it, against any and all attacks. And basically, of course, we've experimented with germ warfare. We know that. We've experimented with nuclear warfare. We certainly are aware of that. And this is a new kind of weapon using individuals. But also, again, as I mentioned before, it's one that will have huge effects on how society operates going forward. Now, we talked about some of the negative things, but certainly some of the positive things are things like Alzheimer's probably can be eliminated. Things like cancer can probably be eliminated. So these genetics, really, it's like a coin. One side that's very bright and the other that's very dark. And it really is a matter of choice. And just going back to the Mojave incident and what Dawn Hess had said about when our universe stops mattering to us and starts mattering to them. Well, I think that's kind of a warning. And I think if we choose the wrong side of the coin and use these great technologies, these grin technologies for nefarious purposes, bad things will happen. On the other hand, if there's an enlightened view of the future, somebody that has a vision that's positive and constructive, clearly that will bode very well for the way our children live.
Oh, yeah. And like you say, it's the yin and yang. You've got the dark and the light use in these things. And I'm in British, I've just pulled up a story here. The British Academy of Medical Science has published a paper explaining the necessity for new rules to avoid ethical missteps, specifically the injection of human brain cells into animals that may give animals human memories or thought consciousness as a goal should be dealt with differently than non-modified animals. Well, you start looking at stuff like that. Are you going to put human brain cells into a very high steroid, big German shepherd and send it out as a military tool or a policing tool?
Yeah. Well, I mean, doesn't all this start to sound like science fiction from the 1950s?
Yeah.
Like the Island of Dr. Moreau, H.G. Wells.
Yeah.
It really gets kind of creepy. But again, these things have, dual purposes, and we have choices as to how we use them. Maybe you and I don't, but certainly our leadership does. And that's very important. For example, this Daisy, the sheep that was cloned so many years ago, mm-hmm. decades ago, they proved that they could clone. I'd be very, very surprised if countries like Russia, China, the United States, Japan hadn't participated in human cloning. I'd be very, very surprised.
Oh, yeah. It when you get some of these states that are less than ethical anyway. On a Western.
How about North Korea, for example?
Oh, yeah. North Korea, yeah. That's a one pile of really strange people. Actually, I shouldn't say that. Some really strange leaders with a bunch of very strange people. That is, they're kind of scary, those guys. Luckily, remember not too long ago, there was people were all throwing their arms up in a panic that they had, North Korea had detonated a hydrogen bomb underground. And they said they did. We've detonated a hydrogen bomb. Well, the media went crazy on it. How could they do this? We've got to really look at them. Well, they also said they landed a man on Jupiter or Venus on an 18-hour trip. They also found a cave where unicorns existed. But it's the hydrogen bomb one that we're believing them on. So,
well, there's no money in unicorns.
Yeah,
but there's a lot of defense contracts and hydrogen bombs. I think that has a lot to do with it.
I'd be afraid if somebody showed up on a unicorn, going, "Oh, that's kind of spooky."
Well, actually, about 80% of DARPA's funds that go into research are spent at universities like MIT, Carnegie Mellon, Stanford. So to set these genetic engineering experiments for slaughter machines in Princeton is not without its historical basis.
Oh, wow. Yeah, it's...
And then they get huge sums of money for it. Huge sums of money, and they're really not accountable because at the end it's all highly classified. So no one can talk about it. And so these experiments, are what they are, with no oversight by anyone.
Yeah. Yeah, there's some of these are private companies that are getting involved, kind of described by some people as the elite are obsessed with merging man and machine and transhumanism and immortality. A lot of these, I think there was the 2045 program that creates a new vision of human development dealing with the global changes and to do with a radical extension of human life and age. Well, how's that going to work if, we barely have enough to pay people Social Security now or a pension when they're dying in their 80s, let alone in the 140s? Who's going to be looking after these people?
It becomes abundantly clear when you see everybody texting and on cell phones and microsurgery that reattaches limbs, heart transplants, kidney, liver transplants, etc., is that technology has so leapfrogged over societal wisdom, societal restraint, societal direction, that the two are not merged at all. And so you're right. I mean, you have societies that are living in today's world, but technology that is created for something far in the future and far more advanced than the culture is ready for.
Oh, yeah. And I've seen, I've interviewed people who have seen that culture issue. I worked with people like that. They were in the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, and during the conflict in I was going to say Sarajevo, but yeah, it was Sarajevo. It was the Balkans, that whole conflict, that war. When they went there from here, like once the communist government pulled out and left everything unfettered, that's when you got into that ethnic cleansing and things, and people were coming in nuts. Well, the Mounties got put in there as peacekeepers to help the police. And they said, yes, these people were almost a third, well, not third world. They were and not Stone Age, but they were 500-600 years almost mentally behind the West.
Amazing, like primitive.
Yeah, they were primitive. They look like your grandfather. He said there was a Caucasian guy walking down the street, a little bit, a growth of beard, wearing a sports jacket and a t-shirt and a pair of dress pants, pulled them down and had a bowel movement in the street, pulled up his pants and kept walking. And he said that you look at them and their culture was so far behind. And what was frightening to them, those who did have access to things like satellite dishes and getting, and now as they were open to the West, seeing the advancement the West had, they realized how far behind they were, which caused an entire spiral of, my God, who are we? We've got to get out of this country. There's so much more out there to learn. And it was the most confused place these guys had ever worked. It was horrendous. Yeah.
Well, I think a very pragmatic example of that, along with your own, is these cattle mutilations that you hear about. And, of course, there are many theories, and one of them is that UFOs hover and take them and whatnot. But my theory is this. My theory is that in the 60s, we did, in the 50s, we did a tremendous number of above-ground and underground nuclear testing, where we'd explode bombs. You know, and the radiation would go into the air, it would come down in the rain, and basically it would affect crops, the crops that we eat, everything that we eat. The ground was basically poisoned. And so I think the cattle mutilations are not aliens. I think they're government scientific experiments to see how much the radiation levels have gone down year to year to year, decade to decade, since those nuclear explosions. And if you look at the cancer rates from that time to this time, it's explosive. It's explosive in this country. But I go to Europe a lot and other parts of the world, and occasionally have a glass of wine and talk about things like this. And a fellow that a high-level executive in a German company was shocked about the number of personal friends I have that either had cancer, have cancer, or, you know, close friends, et cetera. He said, you know, I can look at my list of friends. I'm in human resources, the people that work in this company, and it's not even a fraction of that number. So I think that's an example, I think, of technology just overreaching the civilization, the society that we're in.
Yeah, and not knowing, you know, when you split an atom, how did you know that stuff that came down out of it was going to kill everybody? And then,
well, the other thing is Enrico Fermi, who was one of the designers of the bomb, his theory was that once the atom split, it would be the end of the world because all atoms would split. That basically everything would unravel, and existence as we know it would be destroyed, like pulling the thread on a suit. Of course, that didn't happen, but who knew? And with this genetic engineering, not of people, of vegetables, of fruits, and things like that, who really knows what it leads to? Now, I'm not, you know, suggesting we don't do these things, but I am suggesting, as the Greeks would say, proceed, but proceed carefully.
Yeah, baby steps. But a lot of these things are found when we're trying to fix something. Like a professor of psychiatry at Harvard, Roger Pittman, was experimenting with propranolol? So, which is a beta blocker, mm-hmm. believed to erase terrifying memories. Well, mm-hmm. you know, in very traumatic things. Well, if you're going to, that's the stuff you'd be giving a soldier to alleviate the psychological effects of war, you know, basically cutting out post-traumatic stress. Well, mm-hmm. you add that to the steroids, you add that to transcranial magnetic stimulation, giving you that higher mental processing. You add that with all these other things, and you've built yourself your super soldier.
Yes.
But, you know, each of those things were probably created for good. But like anything else we create, we're always, somebody's going to find a military use for it, whether it is the axe or the pointy stick or fire.
So it seems, and again, I think that this is something people should be more aware of. And of course, Lance Armstrong, wins, race after race after race. Mark McGuire hit 70 home runs. Sammy Sosa, 70 home runs. Things that have never been done before. You look at their bodies, and they're different bodies. You know, you take these people and you look at what, as athletes, they looked at 2 years before. And they were very normal looking. Now all of a sudden they're muscle bound, et cetera. So these are transformations that go on, but that's as we see it. I'm convinced that that it, in the military, DARPA, the DOD, et cetera, that experimentation on humans goes on all the time. And the idea of a transhuman is not only theoretical, it's very real.
Yeah, I'm sure they're out there. In fact, I did some lecturing in Atlanta to some U.S. policemen who are ex-military, and I can tell you that they didn't appear human to me. They were looking at me with their eyes raised when I was talking about drugs in Canada, and they're looking at me saying, so you're not going to arrest somebody who's like a heroin addict? And I said, well, no, heroin addicts are that's a medical condition. It's not a they're not bad. They didn't wake up one day and say, I'm going to be addicted to heroin.
So yeah, yeah.
Why would you arrest somebody who's a drug user? Why wouldn't you just kind of go after the guy supplying the heroin addict?
Exactly.
And try to get the heroin addict into recovery. And they're just looking at me and like, they have no necks. These guys, they were huge, but because their pension was transferable in a lot of cases, they came out of the U.S. military. They saw combat. They saw a lot of terrible, terrible things.
Sure, sure.
They came into policing because that's what they wanted to do, but they hadn't been switched off. So
yeah, yeah. Very interesting.
That was the scary part. A lot of them, like that was very, very few. But as the military comes back from operations in Iraq or overseas or anything, and these guys come back and they want to get a job in the public sector, they get into the military, the Secret Service, anything like that. There's got to be almost like a deprogramming because they are switched on. And I worked with a guy who was the first Canadian to get into the British SAS since the Second World War. He was a British commando in Northern Ireland for 10 years, Canadian citizen, came back, retired. And I worked with him. He taught us how to do rural surveillance when I worked in an organized crime agency. This guy, when I first met him, was completely switched on. It took him about a year to realize that you just couldn't. If we were doing surveillance on, and would this actually happen? We were doing surveillance on a ecstasy lab, a meth lab in a house, and we had a warrant that allowed us to go in and take a sample of this product just to make sure that we saw it. It's called it's a sneak and peek warrant, but it's we had to make sure that the bad guys were left, so we had a surveillance team on them, and there was only one way onto the property, and we said, okay, if somebody, what we'll do is while we're doing the warrant, we'll have an old beat up van pulled over across the driveway by a local police car. And this fellow, the ex-soldier, said, no, it's okay, I can deal with him. And we said, no, this is how we're going to do it. No, it's okay, I can deal with him. And his partner said, all right, how would you deal with him? And everybody stopped and looked at him, and he just turned around and walked away. Yeah, because he would also had been up for 4 days, basically. So, he realized you can't do that in a civilized society. You can't just fire a semi-automatic weapon or a fully automatic weapon in a windshield.
Yeah, a lot of that goes on right now, as you know, and it had been caught on video cameras, et cetera. But, you know, really, what you see in many ways, whether it's germ warfare, whether it's grin technologies, whether it's altering human beings in mass, whether it's atom bombs. If you go back to what Dawn has said in the Mojave incident, it's like we're running towards a cliff. And at some point in time, we're going to run out of luck. And maybe that's when these kind of contacts, this kind of contact that we were discussing earlier, happens. When we're on the verge of a real and true catastrophe, much like this angelic presence rescued them, from their terror and obvious demise from heart attack or whatever, or just going crazy. Maybe that's what's in the cards too. Maybe people have a kind of savior complex, a kind of built-in hope and belief that there's more to this existence, and that somewhere we're being watched, and that somewhere, when it gets really radically wrong, we'll be helped, we'll be relieved, and That's an interesting concept, I think, because almost whatever you talk about in terms of weaponry, in terms of war, in terms of, again, globalization with disease, et cetera, It's a situation where I think we've been very lucky up until now, but I think the Mojave incident, for example, is a very hopeful message in the end.
Yeah, I think so. I think so, too. And I totally agree with where you were going with the some other civilization, some other energy stepping in when we start going afoul of what we're doing to our planet or maybe our race or not race, our civilization. You know, we had that just proliferation of UFO sightings after the nuclear after our nuclear tests in the 1940s. All of a sudden,
absolutely,
we had UFOs flying all over the place. What were they doing? They're coming down, going, "Oh my gosh, those guys got the bomb." What, you know, when we leave the kids alone in the playroom, something's going to happen. So let's go down and check it out. We're are like the little kids of the universe, I think. And as we screw this planet up, I think there is going to be more and more intervention. And I think that's why we're all coming to a little bit more enlightened about this thing. And we're getting back to that first conversation we had about more people being more understanding to this in a conversation, as opposed to 20 years ago where you were called a lunatic and we were throwing, you know, our beer cans out of the window of the car. Now it's being a little more sensitive to energies around us, ourselves around us. And of course you've got, and then you do have that money issue. You've got a professor of biotech at Pennsylvania State University, Jonathan Marino, who allegedly gets a $40 million allocation to do research into fatigue tests and basically where something where someone, let's say a soldier, doesn't feel pain, terror, or suffer from fatigue, and by on the wiring of the brain. So it's, you know, basically rewiring somebody's brain so you're not going to have that hot stove reaction when you put your hand on it. It's bizarre, absolutely bizarre.
It really truly is. But you know what? One of the positive things that that first of all make a lot of this plausible, and you know, as far as grin technology and the rest, is quantum mechanics. I think people formerly would say things like, "Well, this planet or whatever is so far away, it would take, you know, 100 years, and, you know, for somebody to come here." But now with quantum mechanics, they really see the universe in a much different way. Things like wormholes, for example, you know, things like black holes, which no one knew existed just a short while ago. I think we're going to find out that our existence is much different than we ever thought it was. That the things we hold as truth and reality are just glimpses of a reality that are not grounded in what we think is real at all. That the universe is a strange and complex and intricate place that probably has many, many life forms, and that probably, again, getting back to human beings and this compulsion for war and military and destruction, that ultimately the consequences are grave. But hopefully, as you say, there's somebody or something or some civilization that maybe created us, maybe we're the sons and daughters of, that care about our existence and have a vested interest in keeping us going.
Yeah, we could be the little brothers, or we could be the canary in the universe coal mine. And if as things go a little haywire here, they say, okay, something's going on. We got to go down and make it better. And maybe we can get Jack Madsen to help us out with that, too.
Well, you know, the thing about Jack Madsen is that he's kind of an everyman. So, you know, he drinks more than he should, and he takes drugs that he shouldn't. But at the end, he's a good guy, and the metaphysics of Jack Madsen is told by a priest named Father Jeremiah, who believes that there are angelic presence, angels present in this world who don't know they're angels, who carry on a mission from God or the One Supreme or whatever you want to call a deity, and don't know it. In the end, they do. But actually, they're an angelic presence that has a mission. And the mission, you know, maybe to be a catalyst for something, maybe to prevent something. But that's the larger picture of Jack Madsen in the novel Dark Angel.
Oh, very cool. And that's why on the cover you've got an angel in behind him, the Dark Angel.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Very cool. It is very cool. And thanks very much, Ron, for dropping by. And we probably aren't going to know the answers to this in our lifetimes, but in our children's lifetime.
That's what I hear.
Yeah, that's what I hear. And I appreciate you coming by again. We're with Ron Felber. Please go to his website, ronfelber.com. Look at his new book, Dark Angel. It's the part of the, what I call the trilogy, the thriller trilogy of the Jack Madsen series. Remember his nonfiction book, The Mojave Incident. Well, I'm going to say it's 99% nonfiction because...
Oh, it is nonfiction, yes.
Yeah, because you did change the names to protect the innocent at the time. But now it's a brilliant book, and you really have to look into it. And I also want to remind everybody, The Mojave Incident will be on Paranormal Witness in October, so keep an eye out for that. Dark Angel, there's a screenplay being written for that one. And The Hunt for Khun Sa, a Burmese drug lord, that is a series or a show written by Ron Felber, a study that he did, actually hired to go out and write about it. Just real quickly, tell us about that one and how you got into The Hunt for Khun Sa, the Burmese drug lord.
Well, I had a friend of a friend who was in the DEA and became pretty high up, and actually told me, you know, at a Christmas party, I have a great story for you. And this is generally the way these stories come up. So at the time, I, you know, was working on something else, and I really wasn't interested in drugs or drug lords in Burma. It didn't really seem, you know, like something I wanted to do. So then I realized this guy had an army of 30,000. That he was entertaining world leaders at his compound in the Shan jungles, and that basically he was the government of Burma. And then it became a lot more interesting how two blue-collar type, you know, the sons of blue-collar type families brought down the biggest drug lord in the world.
Oh, very cool. And this is, and again, this is something that Netflix is looking at for a series.
Yeah, they the rights have been purchased. They're going to do a pilot, and hopefully Netflix likes it. But I think they will, because basically they commissioned this Living Films to find something you know, along these lines.
Oh, very cool. And look at the track record you have. You know, Paranormal Witness. You've got Dark Angel screenplay being written for the film. You're just one of those famous guys now.
Yeah.
Not gonna,
I'll tell you what.
Next year,
you know
wouldn't
what
be talking
they say? I'm an overnight success. It took me 60 years to get here.
60 years to get. And I was just saying, you know, Ron, in 6 months, you won't even talk to me. So
I doubt that.
All right.
Well, always a pleasure to talk to you.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Ron. And thanks again. And I really appreciate it. And we are going to be giving away a couple of Dark Angels books, as well as The Mojave Incident. And we're going to be doing that to our Spaced Out Radio Space Travelers. It's a group that follow us along and have access to a really cool bit of information through our website at www.spacedoutradio.com. And you too can become a member of this SOR Space Travelers group. And we'll be giving away little bits of swag and books like Dark Angel and The Mojave Incident. So again, thank you very much, Ron, and great success. Wishing you great success on the Netflix project, as well as the Dark Angel project, and all your other projects.
Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. It's always fun to be on.
Thanks again, and have a wonderful
week. Okay.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
And this our last goodbye. Young hearts will stop. Torn souls set free, all that we have is now. If this is what you want, then come.
That's it. Let's roll.
And hey.
Let's be careful out there.
Far over the snow, what are those voices? To get the man that I know. Run through the hay.